Hey, yo, what's good? What's good? What's good? Welcome to Reflections of a DJ, the Road Podcast. I'm DJ Crooked. I got DJ Neva.
Yo, what up?
DJ D Miles.
What's good?
We got Jamie the Great.
Yep.
We got a special, special, special guest by way of Toronto, eh? Canada, eh?
From He's the a Red sick Bull, man, eh?
From the Red Bull 3 style. Judge. I guess, and also one of the best scratchers we see in the game.
Probably.
And then, and you, Jamie, you said this earlier. Is it the first?
The first piece of DJing video I ever seen in my life was Scratch Bastid.
The Star Wars.
The Star Wars, yeah.
Just the, notorious,
the man behind the notorious, is it the DMC Star Wars routine?
It's no, from Scribble Jam.
We got Scratch Bastid in the building. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you
Such
for having me.
Iconic piece of DJing.
Yeah. Let's talk about that, actually.
Sure. Let's go.
Well, how did that come about over there?
All right. So I grew up in Halifax, Nova Scotia. And that's like far east of Canada. It's one time zone east of Eastern Standard Time. It's Atlantic Standard Time. It's this little like appendix that's hanging out over Maine, basically. It's in the Atlantic Ocean, basically. And we had a pretty tight hip hop scene, like local hip hop scene. It's like a city of 350,000. But like going back to like the '80s, people would get tapes from New York and stuff like that, cousins down in New York and stuff. And even though it was isolated, like there was like a lot of stuff happening in the city and the musicians were working with each other and we had a strong scene. So I got into hip hop through Much Music. Well, I mean, just music in general. I was watching everything in the '90s. So this would have been like kind of like the Nirvana era, era. And then, I got into Method Man and then the Wu-Tang Clan, and I was like obsessed with the Wu-Tang Clan.
Right.
That was like that was kind of like my entry into hip hop. Really.
We were like all upset. Like Wu-Tang was just a big part of all anyone in hip hop in the '90s.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. And it, you know, I like collected baseball cards and stuff like that, and something about the clan, like all the members and stuff that really appealed to me. Like at like the
they had their own identities,
the Wu-Tang, all the aliases and everything. Mm-hmm. So I was super into hip hop, and then I discovered. You know, at the time I thought, okay, hip hop only happens in the States, but then I started tuning in on to like college radio and finding out that there was a really dope scene in Halifax. So I got into the scene, and at that time, so there's this guy, Buck 65, and this other guy named 6-2, and they were signed to Anticon Records. So Anticon was like this super like underground label from California. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like that. In they did stuff like kind of in the realm of like Rhymesayers and Atmosphere, and sort of like this like, you know, indie sort of like left field a bit hip hop stuff. And they connected at Scribble Jam. They went one year. They went down to Scribble Jam. So I had connected with them through the local scene. I kind of started going to shows, and then I started entering battles. And I entered this battle, connected with them. And really, really looked up to them. And then they went to Scribble one year, and they were like, this is, I think it was like 2000 or something like that. And they came back, and they're like, yo, like it's like the promised land, you know, like this dope hip hop festival. And like in Cincinnati, they're like, yeah, like it's crazy. Like everyone from all over comes. They got, you know, B-boys, graffiti, MC battle, live performances, and a DJ battle. And I was like, yo, this sounds, like the way they described it sounded amazing.
I've never even heard of Scribble Jam.
You never heard of Scribble?
Heard of that?
No. I know Scribble Jam because I'm a big battle rap fan. So, like,
and
I
it
know.
Was the battle rap
That's
thing.
That's the one.
In, it was, and Eminem used to go, like, there's footage of Eminem there.
That's so Scribble Jam.
Juice from Chicago was like, you know, like in the 90s, late 90s, like a major battle like
MC
name. He's good freestyle. He's like crazy freestyle dude. He had battles with Supernatural and all this other stuff.
It's funny because Nova Scotia has a few good battle rappers that I really like enjoy. Pat Stay, Hollowhand.
Yeah, Hollowhand.
Those two guys are fucking beasts.
Yeah, for sure. Pat Stay is it. Yeah. So like that's also again it's kind of the lineage of this small isolated hip hop scene in Halifax, Nova Scotia.
It's kind of hood out there, right?
Yeah, like.
Because they kind of describe, in their fucking raps, they describe it as really hood.
Yeah, it's kind of hood, kind of like, I don't know, skittish, you know? It's like, it's kind of hustlers,
but
kind of like fishermen too, you know?
It's like,
I don't know how to describe it. I hope I'm not dissing you, Halifax. But like, it's hard to describe. Yeah. But yeah, it's...
So you were there through like your teens and everything.
Yeah,
huh?
So I grew up just like 20 minutes outside of Halifax in a town called Bedford, and I used to take the bus in and just like... hang out on the weekends and shit like that. So basically, Buck and 6-2 had gone down there, and then they joined the crew, the 1200 Hobos, and that was a crew that Mr. Dibbs, you got to pronounce that B properly. Mr. Dibbs was the head of that, and they had like DJ Abilities, who was in Idea and Abilities, and Precise was in the crew. It was like a Midwest DJ collective, but Mr. Dibbs was making crazy mixtapes that I loved back in the day, one of my favorites. And so they, and he put them down with the 1200 Hobos. It's like, I was like, oh, my dudes went to this place, and they like, they, everything was magic. So I made it a goal of mine to get to Scribble Jam.
Right.
Meanwhile, like I was just I was practicing a lot at home, and Buck was actually still, he was putting out records on Anticon, and he was also still battling. He like fancied himself like, you know, he's like Bo Jackson. Like he like produces, raps, DJs, got a radio show. He was doing everything. I really looked up to him. Mm-hmm. But I was like focusing on DJing, and so I came third in this local battle called the DJ Olympics, and I was like, I'm gonna beat Buck next year. Like he won the first year, right? So this is all kind of happened. So that's 2000, and then this battle comes up, and Buck is kind of like splitting his time between producing. So he starts putting out these records on Anticon, and he put out this record called The Centaur. And it's this song about him being a centaur or something. You know, I said it's like kind of like left field hip hop. Right. And yeah, like he's like, I'm a man, but I'm built like a horse from the waist down. That's the chorus of it. Right. You know, and it's just like, the song is dope. It's super, super dope. And the beat is crazy. He actually sampled the movie Carrie. And it's like the scene in Carrie. And like, it's got this sweeping beat. And the beat is really dope.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, and that was like locally, like everyone knew the Centaur, like it was his big song, at the shows and everything. I'm like, yo, I'm gonna fuck Buck up with the Centaur. So like, I bought two copies of his record that he had out on Anticon, and I'm like, I'm gonna like take his own record and beat him in his battle. And I'm like, I don't know how I'm gonna do it. And then like, so when you're prepping for battles, you know, like, I don't know, you're playing around with something, and man, I was running out of time. Like, I'm like, I want to use this record, but I got to do something good with it. Like, and I'm like, fuck. I can't just like scratch over his record. It's kind of weak. Like, and I didn't know, like I was just trying to figure it out. Nothing was coming to me. And then one day, like I swear, like 3 days before the battle, I'm like messing with his record. And so when you're working on juggles, you kind of pick like different parts, like the one and the three or the different tones. You just try putting them back and forth. So I was going, the beat goes like this. It goes like, dun, 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 dun. Dun, dun, dun. And so I was just kind of going like, you know, like, dun, and like, dun, dun. And then so, but I was just kind of like doing the one, and then I tried the dun, and then I was like, dun, 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 dun. And then one time back, I came back too far, and it was like, dun, 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 dun. And I was like, oh shit, like that kind of sounds like the Imperial Death March. I'm like, okay, can I do this? So I'm like, okay. So I'm like, dun, 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 dun. I was like, oh shit. So like, it was a moment, and I called my friend, like me and this dude, his name was the Cutting Cracker, and he was like my DJ partner at the time.
Yeah.
Shouts out to Joe. And I like, yo, I like got the phone. I'm like, yo, listen to this. And I put the phone up to the speaker, and I, you know, ran to my turntables and did it and picked it up. I picked it up. He's like, oh my god.
You know, it's one of the greatest videos. It is one of the greatest videos of all time.
So I actually first did it in our local battle against Buck. Like I used his record against him, and he had been to Scribble, and they were like from the previous year, they had done like that. Those records were kind of big down there in on that indie hip hop scene.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So like it definitely worked at home, and I'm like, maybe this will work at Scribble Jam too. Yeah. So I took it down to Scribble, and I was 18, 19 at the time. I was still like, I'd probably been DJing for 3 or 4 years. So I was like, still a little green. Like I knew I could cut a bit, but like I was going up against, the guy that won that I actually didn't win the whole battle that year. I only won one round. I lost in the final to DJ Sprite. Sprite won that battle.
Sprite? Which one? Not from
the club DJ.
Yep.
Really?
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Sprite won that battle. He was in that
S-P-R-Y-T-E.
battle.
Oh, yeah, wow. I didn't know he was a battle DJ.
He was in a crew called the Platter Pirates.
Wow. The Platter Pirates? Mm-hmm. What was the other one? The something Hobos?
The 1200 Hobos. 1200
Hobos?
Yeah.
We got to talk about these names, man.
Yeah. Right. You know, the Midwest will do that to you, man. So yeah, I actually ended up losing. Like, so basically, I went in this battle. Okay, I got you. Got I don't know. You back in the vinyl days, you could only have carry so many records and have so many routines. Mm-hmm. So I think I brought like 8 routines with me, like max. Like I just didn't have that much on, and it's hard to make up routines, like especially in the vinyl days when you don't have everything and everything costs money, and you know you're an 18 year old kid mowing lawns for records. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I took down these things, and then like, and I also I won the first round with a little routine, and then in the next round, I faced DJ Kiko, and he's this dude from Texas, and he's nasty with his juggles. Like, I knew his videos and stuff like that, and I'm like, I'm dead. Like there's no way I can do this, dude. But I was like, I knew that I had to get off this Star Wars routine. Like, I'm like, I wanted to use it in my final to win the whole shit, but I'm like, okay, if I don't do this now, I'm never going to do it.
Right.
And that was like the best decision I ever made in my DJ career. So like, and you can see in the video, like, cause he was, I don't know, 25 or something like that. Mm-hmm. And he's nasty with the doubles. And like, I think he thought I was easy money. You know? So you like, and I kind of start with like a long scratch intro. And like, I kind of had an unorthodox battle style. I wasn't really like hyper cuts. I was a bit more sort of like funky musical stuff. I'm not really like a power scratcher at that time.
You're not
time.
Like the aggressive cuts.
Yeah, exactly.
Very
and or like on 45 and like kind of going ham and push juggles. It wasn't really my thing. So I just kind of did this like Star Wars themed. I scratched over like a Phoenix Orion Star Wars sampling record and I scratched Star Wars cuts. And he's probably like, what is this kid doing right now? You know? And you can kind of see him. He's like standing with his hands behind his back and he's sort of like, you know, and then I finished the thing, and he kind of gives me like a golf clap, like when I'm done the scratch section.
Is he the guy right behind you?
Yeah,
the chubby guy with the Technique shirt.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, okay. That's DJ Kiko.
Oh, okay.
And then I'm like setting it up, and I go, the time's running out, only 30 seconds to go, and I put a piece of tape on it, and it was a 45 jungle remix of this song. Only 30 seconds to go, only 30 seconds to go, only 30 seconds to go, and then I brought in the dun 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 dun. And like people knew that beat, and then when I brought the beat in, I was like, people went, oh, and I was like, oh shit, it's on.
Yeah,
like
if they know the beat,
you know, if they know the beat, it's about to be on. So like they set it up, and then like, you know, I go and dun 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 4 times, and then like stop and look at them, and then drop the dun 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 dun, 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 and the crowd just went, and like you watch the video, Mr. Jibs comes back. Like the whole
shit erupts.
And Kiko's just like, he just kind of drops his head. And he's just, God, I let this little ginger from Nova Scotia fuck me up like that.
That's fucking crazy, yo.
Yeah, so that was Scribble.
Thanks, bro. Thanks.
Yeah, I know. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that. That was, I remember shit. I saw it in a hip-hop video, and that was like the first piece of DJing like in that form I ever seen.
Was it on the Scribble Jam DVD maybe?
I don't know.
Because it got...
I was ripping shit off of Kazaa.
Right.
Like that downloading site.
Yeah,
I was just ripping shit down.
So Scribble put out like a year-end DVD every year, or VHS at that point even, and it would have the MC battle, highlights from the MC battle, highlights from the graffiti, because Scribble was a graffiti magazine. That's how it started. And then the B-boy battle, and then they would have highlights from the DJ battle. And so that video got around in the underground circles. People knew it. Like, I would go places. I used to tour with some underground cats, and people were like, yo, the Star Wars routine, bro. Like, they knew it from that video. Yeah. It became... And then someone ripped it. Like, this is, like, early days of internet, anything, pre-YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Somebody ripped it, and they put it on E-Bomb's World and College Humor. Like, it ended up on these College Humor. I don't know if you remember either of these sites, E-Bomb's World. These are like funny video sites before YouTube.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And on College Humor, it was actually like in the, it's called Star Wars DJ, and it was like in the toolbar or something. It was like at the top of their website for like 2 years. It just said Star Wars DJ.
But it wasn't you.
It was me.
It was you.
And when you clicked on it, you know, it would just pop up and it had no information about me. It was just me doing my thing.
Star Wars DJ.
So then when YouTube came out, like someone uploaded it over to YouTube, and in the first video it just said Star Wars DJ, like, you know, like 10 characters, Star Wars DJ, all lowercase, and that was just who I was. And I had to roll up there like, yo, that's me, like Scratch
Bastid. I didn't know it was you until recently. I was like, wait, that was him?
Yeah, it's 2001. Like, yeah, it's like 18 years ago now.
That's fucking crazy, right?
It's insane. Was that like before they used to call you DJ Smurf, or...
Oh yeah, you did me homework, did you? my name was Scratch Bastid during that one. Yeah, my first name was DJ Smurf because my last name is Murphy, and like I thought DJ Smurf was I don't know. I thought it was a good alias.
But it's not bad.
It's not bad. But, you know, there is a DJ Smurf. He's like Atlanta. He's like a Atlanta, Miami-based DJ. Like, he's like a... And so I was flipping through the source one day, and I was like, oh, shit. There's already a DJ Smurf.
So how did you come up with Scratch Bastid?
Yeah, where did that come from? Yeah.
Well, my first name when I entered that battle that I talked about when I came, like, third place before I won it, my name entering that battle was DJ Stimulus.
Pause. Yeah.
Like, it was all this, you know, in the era of, like, scientific, lyrical, miracle shit. And yeah. Like, you know, I'm going to be, I don't know what I, you know, you're trying to figure out something unique. And I entered that battle, and then, like I was the first up in that battle, and I was, like, 16 years old, and, like, I entered, and I remember the MC, who's my friend now, Tachichi, he got in the mic and said, first up, from Bedford, Nova Scotia, DJ Stimulus. And I remember someone in the crowd goes, DJ Stimulus.
I gotta change that now.
Like, I was like, oh, damn. You know, it sounded awful. And that was the first round. And like, I made it, ended up making it through the finals. And even by the finals, I was like, no, that ain't my name anymore. Like this was like 2 days later. There was the finals. I was like, no, just call me Paul. Like, I didn't have a name. I don't know. I guess I just got by being DJ Paul. Like, well, I didn't settle on that name or anything.
Those already a DJ Paul, too.
I know. It was an intermittent name at the time. You know, like, I was like, fuck it. Like, I guess I'm just DJ Paul. I came in third, and that was cool. So I connected with these people. So the other half, Buck 65, the other half of his crew was this guy 6'2", and 6'2" was my home. Like, he was the dude that I was really, like, hanging out with, and he was showing me cuts and letting me crash on his couch and stuff like that, and showing me records and sampling, and he showed me a lot of the ropes. Like, I owe a lot to him. 6'2" is still my homie today. And he really put me on in some ways, you know what I mean? Like, he was like, we all have like a hip hop mentor, and he was to me that he was one of them. So he and this other guy, the Drunkness Monster, they lived together.
Name. Are you serious? Are you these names?
Are you just coming up with this?
I think you're fucking like, with us, man.
He's like, let me see how much I can stretch this fucking joke.
This is literally like Usual Suspects, where he just keeps talking, like, and he's just naming these names.
He's
and
looking
shit
at
from little things he's seeing in the fucking room.
There's a Blackness Monster picture up there.
DJ Full House.
Yeah. So they lived together, and they were like, you know, they'd do shows around town, and they would teach me the cuts. And so I would go in, take the bus in. This is when I was still in high school. And then I go home. On the weekend, I'd go in and practice and learn from them and go home and just like cut. And then I'd go in like next weekend or whatever, and I'd go back, and I'd have the cuts. And like, they were like I think, like, in a way that, you know, they weren't really pissed off. They're like, who is this little, you know, like, who is this kid, you know? And I guess my nickname around them, like, they nicknamed me amongst themselves the little scratch bastard, you know, the little bastard, you know.
That's kind of awesome.
Yeah, and I didn't know, like, unbeknownst to me, that's what they were calling me. But Rob is one of those dudes that just makes up nicknames for people, you know. You know, some of those dudes just got these nicknames.
Yeah.
And he's named so many people, like, homies of ours. So he also ran the first this website called Triple Bypass, which was super ahead of its time. They got a government grant and they had super high, like, this is like when the internet didn't have pictures, they had all the pictures, you know. It was like, it was a media website, and it was super fast, and they, you know, I was always trying to get in, like, be a part of anything that was going on, because I was really trying to get on. And and then they were like, yo, we have an internet radio show. And I was like, internet radio show? Like, what is an internet radio show? There's the internet, and then there's the radio. Like, how do these things coexist? Even streaming didn't make any sense to me. You know, you could download, it would take you 20 minutes to download a 1 megabit.
Still low, you know, like, very early stages of all that, right?
Yeah, exactly. So I was like, but I'm like, whatever. Like, I guess so. Like, I'm down because I want to be down with whatever. So so I'm like, okay. So he's like, what day can you do? I'm like, on Tuesday at 8 or something like that, right? And I'm like, cool. And he's like, all right, I'm going to post the schedule, like, you know, I'm going to post the schedule tomorrow, and you can, you know, check it out or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, and so I didn't have internet with the images. So I called my homie, Cut and Cracker, and I'm like, yo,
Cut and Cracker.
Cut and Crack. You missed that one? I already said that one.
Yeah, it went on the
radio. So I called him. I'm like, yo, I think 6'2 posted the schedule. Can you go look at it? I just want to see, like, who's around me or whatever. I'm like, I'm at Tuesday at 8. And he's like, man, he's like, I don't see your name on here. And I'm like, what do you mean? I guess at the time I thought it would just be like DJ Paul or whatever. And he's like, I'm like, who's in the slot? He's like, it just says Scratch Bastard. And I'm like, who's and like for everyone else, it had a genre, and it would be like hip hop, house, techno, and mine just said scratching. It said scratching beside, and I was like, it said Scratch Bastard, and it says scratching, and I'm like, what the hell? And so then I call up 6-2, I'm like, man, who's this dude in the name in my spot? And he's like, man, that's you, man. You're this little bastard that keeps coming here and stealing our scratches.
And did he spell it the way you spell it now?
No, just said scratch bastard.
Actually, like a scratch bastard.
And a bastard. Yeah. But, you know, we were all, like, at the time, just, like, into just changing letters around. Mm-hmm. So, K, I did K because, like, Scratch Pickles, and they were doing, like, the K on the back of the records and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then Bastard, I just put the I just like to like lighten the R a little bit, like bastard. I didn't want it to be the scratch bastard.
Yeah,
I just wanted it to be like you bastard. Like it's kind of like a East Coast thing, you know what I mean? Like Boston or New York or something like that. I just pictured it, or like you know Billy Dan's and MOP just like, bastard. You know, just like so. I just spelled it like that. ID. It wasn't because I didn't want to swear or anything. It just was that was the tone that I wanted to be said.
Because I think what do you call it? I linked up. We linked up for you to do this podcast to Marvel. Once again, big shout to Marvel. Mm.
Our fucking PR.
Yeah,
right. he is my PR. Yeah.
And then in the group chat, he's just like, "Yeah, he's like, hey, Crooked, this is Bastid." And I'm just like, "Oh shit! Yeah. Like, is that what they call it? Like,
yeah, call you just Bastid? Call me Bastid? Yeah, for sure. It's my closest friends call me Bastid.
I was like, yo, like, what do I call him? Scratch or a bastard? Like,
Scratch is cool, but there's like a lot of scratches. You know, of course, there's DJ Scratch. Yeah. There's also in Toronto a DJ starting from scratch. And so he's kind of scratched. So when I moved there too, it's like okay, like I there's a lot of scratches. It's pretty common, like
it's a lot of scratches.
But there's not a lot of bastards. You know what I mean?
So at one point, did you move to Toronto or head there?
Well, so I first moved to Montreal. Uh-huh. So I moved to Montreal.
Great city.
Yeah, great city.
Great city.
Yeah. So basically, I was doing like three nights a week, a bunch of shows in Halifax. It was mm-hmm. Halifax is a great party city because it's like a university city, so like it was good living, like we were having fun, having a blast, like you know, I started to make money, like you know, I remember when I first made rent, you know, like oh right, shit right. Like and then like I'm like
did almost. You ever have like a regular job?
I worked at the record store there. Oh, so that was like I've worked at a place called Canadian Tire, which is like
Canadian Tires.
It's like I don't even know what the U.S. equivalent is, but it sells like automotive and it also sells sports and it sells gardening and stuff like that. I worked there for 4 months.
Or like sounds sporting like goods.
Walmart.
Yeah, something like Walmart or something like that, but like the Canadian version. And I worked there for 4 months. I got paid $5.05 an hour.
Wow.
Damn.
$5.05. That $05 makes a difference.
I know, right?
Minimum wage at the time. Minimum wage at the time was $5.50, but I got trainee pay for three months because that was they would do that. Damn, and man. Trust me, the second day on the job, I'm doing the same shit everybody else is doing, but it's like $5.05 an hour. That was my first job. But then I was like, then I got offered the job in the record store, and I'm like, this is way better. You know? So, but that's the only real jobs I guess I ever had outside DJing.
So you went to Montreal. Well, you were in a college town.
And things were going good in Halifax, but like, and it was good, but this girl had challenged me actually. Like this girl I dated for a bit, and then like we kind of like stopped dating, and she was a philosophy major, and she kind of like, I always enjoyed chatting with her. She had a good introspective, but she like kind of challenged me. She was like, and this is like kind of like after we dated, she's like, yeah, you got it pretty good here, hey bastard, you know, like, she's like she's like, you know you're playing, you're pretty popular with the ladies, you know, you're living good, the good parties. But she's like, it won't last forever. And I'm like,
wow.
And I'm like at the time, I'm like, come on now, you know it's gonna last forever, I'm the shit, you know, like, right, you know, in my head. But then like she knew like she had this vision and like or whatever, like she totally saw the situation for what it was,
right?
Me in my 23 year old ego, like of course it's like you don't think that way, right? You're just feeling good about it. And she was like, yeah, she's like, don't you want something bigger than this, you know? And I'm thinking to myself, I was like, she's like, if you could move to somewhere, where would you move? And I said, like Montreal. Like I always love going to mm-hmm. Montreal. Like it's, I always have fun there. And it's geographically, it's like the next city up from Halifax. It's 13 hours away. It's like, it's like the next city you go to. So there, and 6-2 had actually moved there, the guy that gave me my name. And so I was like, okay, cool. Maybe Montreal. And then she's like, yeah, you should think about that. And then like 4 months later, I just moved to Montreal.
Wow.
Like
all because of that conversation?
I would say, yeah. I would say if that conversation hadn't happened, it might have. But that conversation was real, like.
It was a spark.
Yeah. And it got me thinking.
Did you ever thank her later, kind of?
Or yeah, I did.
Did you talk to her?
Yeah. No, I haven't seen her in a number of years.
Shout out to Becky out there.
Yeah. Yeah. Rachel. Shout out to Rachel.
Shout out to Rachel. Wow. Yeah.
But I saw her once, like. So then eventually I got this residency in Toronto at the Drake Hotel. I was playing there after I lived in Montreal, and I was taking the train down and I was doing this monthly there, and it was popping. And she came out, she was living in Toronto. She came out there with her boyfriend or whatever, and she saw it. And like, it was like this moment where I was like, yeah, fucking this is, and she was like, I'm really proud of you, you know? Yeah. I'm like, word. Yeah, this is kind of nice, you know? I hope you guys had a good night and everything. It was a very redeeming moment of it. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you have a sort of like a flash to back to me sort of arguing with her about, nah, this is you know, going to be good. And then, you know, like 6 years later, it's way better than it was.
Damn. That's kind of, that's fucking crazy.
Shout out to Rachel.
I have a question. What got you into scratching? Because we talked to a majority of DJs, and we asked them, you know, what made you want to DJ? And everyone says, well, I wanted to produce.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And then the second thing they always say is, I wanted to scratch like Premiere.
Right.
And what's your thing?
I mean, yeah, I love the scratches on records. Uh-huh. But I would say that it was collecting vinyl that made me want to scratch. Mm. So in that indie era of indie rap and everything, mm-hmm. we're talking like Raucous, that whole, you know, Company Flow and that era, underground rap, all these 12 inches were coming out.
Actually, and also the whole underground hip hop time during that era mm-hmm. had some of the best Canadian underground rappers that I'm the biggest fans of, like Socrates,
Cardi,
Choclair. I love mm-hmm. Choclair. Mm-hmm.
So those were all coming out on vinyl, and some of the things were only coming out on vinyl. You couldn't get it on CD or cassette. Mm-hmm. It was only mm-hmm. on vinyl. So I was full on hip hop junkie at this point. Like Wu-Tang kicked the door down for me, and it was like obsession from there. And mm-hmm. and so I needed these exclusive songs that you couldn't get anywhere else. So I started buying records, and then once I started buying the records. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you know, I'd played with my dad's turntable a little bit, but once I got my own records, then I'm really starting to like move them around a little bit. And I'm like, oh, this is kind of cool. You get like a little baby scratch. And of course, like the Primo stuff sounds amazing. I wanted to scratch like Primo, but I had no idea how to do it. But so like, you know, everything sounds, you know, I didn't even know what a crossfader was at that point. Right. Like, but I did kind of figure out there was this little switch that I could hit back and forth, and mm-hmm. it kind of made something sound kind of similar. I'm like, I told my friend Joe Cut and Cracker again, like, I think I figured it out. Like, you move this switch, and because you'd watch the rap, you watch the videos, and they'd be kind of doing something with it. But at that point, like when we were like 14 or 15, we really didn't have someone, and there was no internet. So you're just kind of watching what's on TV, and you're hearing stuff in your headphones, and you're trying to put it together.
That's true, though. Like, I remember just watching that shit. Like, what are they doing with the left hand?
And yeah.
What
are they doing with this and right? You know what? To this day, people are still doing that. Like, even today at CES, there's tons of people who are like, what does that thing do? Right. Yeah. You know, they don't get it. Right. But, you know, everyone has that some point where they figure that shit out. But, of course, we were like, I want to learn more. So the same places we bought all these 12 inches, they had some hip-hop DVDs like Scribble Jam and stuff. Yeah. And they had the battle DVDs like ITF, DMC, and they had some scratch pickles. And the one order I bought from Sandbox Automatic, I don't know if you guys remember this website, but they had all this and they had the Turntable Mechanic Workshop. And mm-hmm. it was a Vestax video with Shortcut, D-Styles, and Qbert. And them in their garage, and they're just cutting on an 05 Pro, and they're just like talking about the cuts and showing. And Qbert is acting a fool, like he's like Qbert's talking like in voices and shit, like oh, like a cowboy and like shit, like it's just weird. I'm like, what is this? But they're like the cuts are crazy, you know. So we were like, oh, this is crazy. So like, you know, at that point, then 6-2 had an 05 Pro. I'm like, I need to try to get an 05 Pro, but like I got this American DJ mixer. This two-channel American DJ for Christmas. It's like, this is like my first little piece of real gear. My dad had a Technics 1500 with two dobs. He's kind of like an audiophile a little bit. And then I got a Pioneer PL200. kind of stitched together, patched together.
Right, right.
And then I got this video, and then I'm like, okay. And I'd watch the video upstairs in the room, and then I'd run downstairs and try my best to do something. Like,
wow. So you learned on those two different turntables.
Yeah.
Were they belt drives or auto?
Both were direct drive, but the Pioneer PL200 has kind of like a spring suspension system.
Right.
So I used to have to stick a piece of plywood underneath it to keep it up.
Oh my God.
You know, like you just kind of MacGyver that shit, you know. And the 1500 had a bit of a warbly pitch to it, but mm-hmm. you could make it work. I still have some tapes that have like kind of warbly pitch and some ideas.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. And so I would try to do whatever I saw on the screen, and then like, of course, like try to like listen to Kubert talking like a cowboy, like in my ear, like, oh, you just gotta move the fader like this or something, like you know, like just stupid. But you just try to do that, and then I try to learn, and then of course later I started entered the first battle, and then like some of the people down there saw that I had some potential to do stuff, and then when I met them, that's when I started learning from them. That's when I became the Scratch Bastid, you know.
Did you actually compete in the DMC?
I did, yeah. So I competed in DMC in Canada four times, and I placed fourth twice and second twice.
Looking at the battles back then, obviously with the difference with vinyl and everything like that, and now with Serato and like cueing and tone play and all of these things that come into play,
mm-hmm.
and then you're going to head over to Taipei, Taiwan for the Redbull 3 style.
Yep.
Which you've been World the ambassador finals. And the, like the judge for since it started.
Yeah. Yeah. So, so like I battled in DMC. I did DMC ITF and Scribble Jam was like, that was Scribble was like the one that like I won titles at that I was like pretty proud of, even though mm-hmm. it was like kind of like a small ish battle. Like it still got my name around good.
You won three times, right?
Yeah. And the DMCs, I never won national finals. It's like Brace beat me once. And when I came second, and Drastic from Thugly beat me once too. So like they both got to go, and the other two times I came fourth, I'd never won. But like at that time, I was doing more club gigs and stuff like that, and that was really starting to work for me. And I started getting tons of gigs from that. And then I heard about this battle that they had for fun in Vancouver called the Three Style, and it was like Headspin was in it, and Matt the Alien, and Flip Out, and a lot of people from Vancouver. And I was like. And it was like basically like this is sort of like when Serato first came out, and everyone in Vancouver, I remember Vancouver, everybody got on Serato right away,
mm-hmm.
and we were a little more resistive. I was still bringing like crates to the club and doing half and half.
Still keeping it real.
Keeping it real, you know.
We were all kind of nervous
keeping
though,
it safe
because we weren't sure exactly if it was going to crap out or not.
Yeah,
if it was
and then
work.
You know when you first try to build your collection. You're like, damn, I don't want to rip all these records or whatever. I got these and like, and you know, like, no, I don't know. I didn't know anyone with the library that I could borrow, or maybe I was too shy or too proud to ask anyone for the library. So I'm like, okay, this works for me and I'm doing it. So I bring my crates with me. Mm-hmm. But in Vancouver, everyone had Serato. And I really feel like that plus like the sort of mashup era kind of created this like chance for people to, like basically it was for fun. They were like, oh, now we can play whatever we want all the time. So they were like, let's have this let's have this little fun competition where people step a little bit outside their comfort zone, mm-hmm. and you got to play at least three styles of music. That was the thing, because everyone had kind of a style, one or two, but then reaching for that third to kind of like, you know, to have fun. It was a fun contest, and I heard about it. And I'm like, oh, this sounds great. Like. Mm-hmm. What y'all scared to invite me to this? I'm gonna fuck up this competition, you know? Like, but they're like, no, this is only here. And then Kenny Mack was working at Redbull at the time, and he was the national culture manager in Canada, and he did that. And then the next year he did it again, and there was like a lineup around the block in Vancouver. It became this really popular thing, and I'm like mad jelly, because I'm like, yo, this sounds so fun, and I want to go in. And he's like, yeah. He's like, I think we're going to take it national. Kenny thought he was going to take it national. Like, all right, word. I'm like, I want in this time. He's like, and Kenny was like, well, I kind of want someone to help me run the contest across the country.
Right.
I want to do 10 across the country. He's like, would you be interested in being a judge and showcasing it at all of them? And then he's like, offered me that as a gig. And I'm like, yeah, damn, that's like 10 shows across the country, flying me everywhere. And
right.
I'm
the real champion here.
That sounds great, you know? So I'm like, okay, like maybe it's time, like this, and this is like basically after I stopped doing Scribble, had stopped doing DMC.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm like, maybe I don't want to like re-enter battles. Like maybe I'm cool here. And then went on that tour, and then it built some steam. We did a national final in Toronto, and word had gotten to Redbull headquarters in Austria that we had like this cool thing, this cool event in Canada that's like a music based event, and they were like, you know, like they flew in the head honchos in Austria and they came and like studied our event, and they're like, this is pretty cool, and they're like, I think we're gonna try to do this on a global scale.
Yeah.
And so the next year it went on a global scale, and there was 9 countries, and then it went, it was in Paris, and then that was the first one in 2010 in Paris. Wow. So it started kind of in 2007, I think, 8, and then 9 was a national Canadian file. There might have been one more. I'd have to check the stats. But then, like, 2010 was the first international one. And at that one, I went and I wasn't actually a judge. I just kind of went along and kind of helped. And then since then, I've been a judge and been a part of it. And now it's in its 9th international year.
Yeah.
21 countries.
I was gonna ask you in the overtime, since, I mean, obviously, since you've been doing battles and stuff since the early 2000s and stuff like that. When you look at the new contestants, or when you look at how the people are, like, people are DJing right now, what do you see the new focuses opposed to like 5 years ago?
As a judge.
And then we talked to Four Color Zach, and sometimes, and he says that, like, he assures us it's not like a DMC battle. It's not like a scratch and technical thing. It's actually more based on the music and how you're mixing it, and I guess you know, like crowd engagement and stuff like that.
Yeah, for sure.
How do you judge it, basically? Yeah,
it's definitely not easy to judge. I think anything, judging any type of like art is sort of like, it's difficult, you know, like it's not, you can't really do it. Everyone has a taste. Some people like, you know, what I'm looking for, like I look for, you know, originality, like what's going to make you last and stand out in the DJ world. Mm-hmm. And I know from personal experience and just like history, like you got to be original is like one of the biggest things. What makes you stand out? You can be technically amazing, but if you don't have something that defines you for you, then someone's going to forget you eventually.
Right.
Or like you're not going to stand out. So I look for originality, like primarily, but and like most of originality like comes from, to me, a lot of it's like what tracks you play. And that kind of relate, like I feel like that's something that I cared about a lot when I battled, even though I knew like it wasn't about, like I knew there were people that could do stuff faster than me, but I'm like, I can pick better records than you and be, I can do stuff that's hard to think of. Mm-hmm. And that's like how I'm going to approach it. Like it may not be hard, the hardest to do, but it's hard to think of.
It's better. It's not, maybe not be as technical or maybe like so focused on the actual scratching skills, but the actual, and then like, you know, if it's conceptually better, then usually means it's more entertaining.
And style, you know, this type of stuff comes up in like snowboarding contests and stuff. Like there's people that do just like flips, 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 flips. And then there's people that just have this, have style. And it's like, the style is kind of like the essence of it. Like for me, like it's, let's talk about DJ Premier. Like when you see Primo cut, he wasn't watching the Scratch Pickles DVD. Sometimes Primo's cuts, like you're like, how is that sounding good? Like the way he's moving his hands, you're like, this is so unorthodox. But the sound that comes out the speaker is just like this chip, chip, chip. It's the sound of scratching. You know what I mean? So like, I think that technicality is a piece of it, and cleanliness is like great. Like it's great, but like what makes you stand out? What's your style? And you can do that a number of ways. You can do that with the scratches that you pick and the musicality. You can do it with the music you pick. You can do it with the way you craft your set, the way you flow over 15 minutes, because that's such a big important part of being a DJ. Mm-hmm. I try to think of what are the valuable skills to be a career DJ, because that's what I think ultimately with Three Style, it exists to improve the environment of DJs.
Like, yeah.
It's not a competition of supremacy. I don't feel that way. I feel like the nature of it is to raise awareness of what we're doing, and that's what it started as a friend, like a friendly battle. And you know, it doesn't have to be roses and happy, and it can still be competitive. Yeah. But like, it's more to sort of raise that, like, okay, like let's have fun and step outside our comfort zone and do something new and creative. And it ultimately, like, let's all make DJing, like, showcase how cool DJing can be.
Yeah.
When you're judging, how important or how much of a determining factor is crowd participation? because I feel like you might come into a situation where someone is really dope, but not from that region.
Yeah.
And someone that may not be as skilled, but has the home crowd behind them.
Yeah. I mean, you always got to, you have to take it into consideration to some degree. But I kind of feel like the person that has hometown advantage, it's almost like a handicap. Like, not like, you know how in golf you have a handicap?
Yeah.
So like you have, like, if you're, it's your home squad, you should be rocking that to a certain degree. Mm-hmm. And you can always go better than that. If it's not your home squad and hometown, whatever, and you win them over, it's like, whoa, he took it from like expectation here to here. So like I kind of feel like there is a bit of a handicap involved there. So like I don't expect the crowd to always give back, because some of them are, you know, depending on where you're at, they don't even, might not be super enthusiasts on the global scale of DJing, so they might not get it. So I take it into consideration, but sometimes someone rocks it for sure and like the doesn't translate to the crowd. But I don't know, as a DJ, I find that there is a way, you kind of have to figure that out. That is a piece of the puzzle that you have to figure out.
Yeah.
I mean, there are cases where the crowd just, it goes over their heads, but it is like the dopest thing you've seen, and you have to give it props. But it can be a little, like, I do think that's an important part of it. But I kind of approach it with that handicap idea, mm-hmm. where it's like, okay, if it might be hard to move the crowd, but if they did move the crowd somewhat and it was a tough crowd and it's not their home crowd, well, then that's an achievement in itself.
Yeah.
So, like, if someone does something amazing, but it's a little bit over, like, some of the contestants' heads, mm-hmm. because, like, or
the crowd's heads.
Yeah, the crowd's heads, yeah, sorry. Yeah, no, what do you call it? Do you still give them the points like that it worked, or you're taking into account that the crowd didn't feel he should have simplified it, you know?
No, I mean, if it's historically amazing, you have to give it the props that it is. Right. Also, because let's remember, like, there's people watching from all over the world on the live stream and things like mm-hmm. that. Like, sometimes if it goes over people's heads, like, it could be the dopest thing you ever see, and we'll go crazy, and the competitors might be going crazy, and it might have gone over the crowd's head, but, like, if they don't stop booing, it's okay. Like, if they don't get it, like, as long as he keeps it going, it could be, you know, that's special. Like as long as it doesn't, like, fail the crowd and let, like, last night at the club or whatever, like, as long as it doesn't clear out the room or something like that, you know, it wasn't me, by the way. And it wasn't anyone in this room. But
yeah, it was Rick James.
Bastid actually just stopped by a club that we all met up at, and I guess the DJ that was at the club just somehow just happened to clear the room out in like 10 minutes. It's like a world record. I've never seen a room clear out that fast in my life.
From that video,
it was like a fire drill. Like, everyone was just leaving.
For real, it was a drum. It was a fire drill.
It was literally like. Please exit to the nearest. Please exit to the nearest exit. And then
right. Everybody was lined up.
Everyone, just, right. Yeah, they were like, everyone was just lining up.
Yeah, man.
Like, the just exit was so packed, you had to get into a single file.
It was almost like the end of like a marching band, like a thing. And then they're like,
it was like a movie theater when the movie was done. Everyone was just leaving through the aisles.
It was pretty epic, man. I've never seen that. That's the first time for that. I know the managers there were like flipping the fuck out, like, what the fuck's going on? But yeah, that's a perfect example.
Yeah, well, and that's the thing. Like, and look, if it's a groundbreaking thing, sometimes it's like it does go over people's heads. That's how groundbreaking shit can be, right? Like, and sometimes it takes a minute to recognize the greatness, or maybe people don't understand exactly what's going on. I remember this girl Sinara from Brazil, when Flip first came out, it was like a beta, like Flip and Serato. She made Flip happen, and none of us had seen it. It literally came out like that day or something like that. And this was in Baku, Azerbaijan. And she did a Flip live, and we had never seen that. And we were like, oh my God. Like, you know, people don't really use Flip like that too much. Like, uh-huh. But she did it right there and like in front of us, and none of us knew how she even did it. Like, we don't know if she talked to Serato or whatever, but she made the loop live, and we were like, this is amazing, and kind of translated the crowd. But for us, it just like that seeing that innovation, mm-hmm. we had like she that really gave her points, and she ended up advancing the next round, and that was part of it for sure.
Has anybody ever sent you like a pizza trying to win you over, you know?
No.
Some flowers.
You know, I mean,
steak dinner.
No, people, you know, I I keep super neutral. It's a thing. Like I don't feel like people ever try to butter me up. But then sometimes people feel a little sort of like, can I even talk to you? I'm like, yeah, you can talk to me. But like, sometimes people be like, well, do you have any suggestions? I'm like, no, I can't really do that. Like, I can't give you a private coaching lesson of what you need to do. Like, I can talk to you about general concepts of DJing, but I can't really say like. Like, yeah, I like can't give you an unfair advantage or something like that.
I'm really
that.
Digging like, dance hall records this month.
Right, yeah, yeah. You're like, this is how to win me over. I can only speak on it publicly. I don't like to give, I can't give anyone preferential treatment. It's not fair.
Is there a certain,
it's like ethical thing, you know what I mean?
Is there a certain style or, like, technique that you're, like, tired of seeing? Like, you don't want to see it anymore? Like, sometimes.
Tone play.
Yeah, I'm pretty over tone play. I got to be honest. I'm not over tone play, but it, unless tone play is exactly in key, or it has to be musically, like, if your tone play is off, it's like I'm taking points away.
What is, like, it at the Rough Rider tone play that you're tired of,
like that? I mean to me it should just never take away. I mean, we talked about Four Color Zach. He kind of, like, to me, he like smashed that game, you know. But like when I did the Star Wars thing, it's kind of like tone play know. So it's sort of like this, like, I can appreciate taking a musical idea and taking it to another level.
But do you appreciate it as much, let's say, that Star Wars? I think we had this conversation, right? That Star Wars
routine
that you did, if you had never done it before and someone did it and they did it on with the cue buttons, would it be the same thing?
It's not the same, dude. The juggle part is the kind of the L factor.
Does the cue points and the S9 mixer kind of, does it kind of ruin the competition a little bit?
No.
Because people get caught up in all the effects and everything.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not crazy about pads. I mean, someone can freak it. But to me, like, in my mind, and I don't want to favor anything over, it's not defining part of DJing. It's like a spice of DJing. So I don't feel like, I feel like if it's a drumming thing, then that's a drumming competition, cool, and it can spice something up, it can elevate and it can do something, but ultimately I'm judging like the flow of your set and the music you play, and it can be a part of the skills, but it's not like, to me, it's a piece of DJing, but it's not really DJing. It's like it's a skill. It's like a piece of the puzzle. And
it's like playing, what is that 80s game Simon Says? Really good?
Yeah. Simon Says.
Well, yeah, like I'm glad you compared it to like a drum pad, like a digital drum pad, or like a beat machine, like where you're like making beats almost, right? Like with the pads.
And that's what it is. And there's parts of that performance, and I don't ever like to say definitively there's a yes or no, because I always like to leave the door open for someone to innovate. Because even scratching is an innovation, you know? And when scratching came into the DMC, people were like, no way, we can't have this, you know what I mean? But then it eventually became what transformed it into this, for better or worse, thing, you know what I mean? Like, and the craze era and rock rated, and like, you know what I'm saying? Like you got to kind of leave the door open for people to define what it is. But for me, I think 15 minutes, the reason the thing is that long is you can't drill something. You have to DJ, you have to play music, and you have to build a flow. And ultimately, if you're the best drummer in the world, that doesn't mean anything if you can't build the flow. You can use it as a tool, but like, be careful, like,
right,
don't go overboard with it.
Do you have a system of judging, like boxing judges go from 1 through 10, 8 around if you fall, if you get knocked down? Do you have like, okay, this was like a 9? How do you judge?
I mean, not really. Like we have like, and they've changed a few times over the years. Just the weightings between originality, creativity, skill, track selection, and crowd response are like kind of like the general 5. And the weighting changes a bit. My personal method of judging is I try to write down as many moments of the set as I can, even in just like chicken scratch. Like, okay, intro, like I kind of like say what is in the intro that the DJ does is, and then kind of try to write down the moments. And then, so that gives me an idea, because they go so fast, right? And after you see 6 people in a row back to back to back, you're like, who did what, you know? So I try to write down a little bit of everything. And I find that if I do that, and then when I go back and I can look at these sets, and I can kind of feel what they built and feel the moments. And then I'm sort of like, and then I look at the, like, look at how many sort of highlights they had and what paid off in the long run. Cause sometimes really dope things happen, but then it, like they don't, they have a big like fart or something. Yeah, like, yeah. It's yeah. like, ooh, you know. And then another guy might have not had the hypest moment, but like overall their set was like amazing, like pace, you know what I mean? So I try to like write down everything that happened, and then from there I'm like, okay, what where do all the categories fit in, and what and then like if something worked I put like a plus plus, and if something didn't work I put like a minus minus. Mm-hmm. And I kind of like I just use that, and that over I find that that is a way to stay true and just remind me of what happened, because it can go so quickly. And so a lot of times that's my first part, is just like jotting down what happens, like taking notes in school or some shit like that.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys want to have any other questions about
that? This has nothing to do with the battle, but I just want to have want to know how you feel about CDJs.
Man, like I want to say I love CDJs, but like yeah, like I think. Have you ever seen DJ EZ?
No.
EZ or EZ from the UK, he's just nasty with.
Oh,
it.
Oh wait, wait, I think I have.
I yeah. mean, he like Boiler Room has posted this thing for a few times, yeah. and they it say it's like nasty. The hypest moment of Boiler Room history, and really? It is bananas. Like what he does with looping and just like the cues and just the way he freaks it. Mm-hmm. Look, like I try to leave the door open for mm-hmm. innovation, because like yeah. let's not forget, like hip hop isn't. It came from all other musics, and the turntable wasn't supposed to be used this way, mm-hmm. right? Yeah, so, yeah. like, if you—that's kind of like the pot calling the kettle black. If you say, "Oh, now we got all these rules," oh, you do. Well, you broke all the rules to start the whole shit. Yeah. So, mm-hmm. so, and CDJs, yeah. I'm not a purist. I still love vinyl. I still love the yeah. sound of turntables. But if you can do something with CDJs that sounds good, mm-hmm. who am I to say that it's right or wrong?
Yeah.
I just think that. With a turntable, it's a bit easier. The sound of scratching is kind of built, like the we know scratching is kind of built around the way a turntable works. Mm-hmm. Digitally, it's a bit different digitally with a CD player and the way that it cuts. But some people can get funky with it too.
Yeah.
Then a CD has its own characteristics. CD player has its own characteristics that turntables don't. That it can even mm-hmm. do certain things even better. And like when I went over to the Netherlands, man, everyone's on CDJs and they freak it over there, man. Like, uh-huh. like, and part of it was like the clubs over there, just the local trends. So like, and you know, in the islands, like all the reggae DJs switch to CDJs, and that was oh, partially yeah? because vinyl, like you know, hard to keep in good condition in some of those right. conditions, like the weather. And it's like,
yeah.
you can't sit here and tell me like you're going to be a purist over people that just literally can't do those things. Mm-hmm. They're going to make their own styles. And you know, when you hear those big old wheel ups, like the super, oh, yeah. mm-hmm. high, that's kind of like a part of that sound. Right. Then at yeah. that point, yeah, yeah. So I'm open to it for sure.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of the islands, you're like from Trini, right? Trinidad.
My mother's from Trinidad.
Your mother's yeah. from Trinidad?
Yeah.
So we were like talking earlier. We're like, yo, he's like, he's got some Caribbean descent. He's yeah. He's in Toronto.
Yeah.
Well, can you do the Toronto like Drake talk? Like the big things, you know what I mean?
Yeah, if I get going, maybe we have a couple of drinks.
It's a real 16, eh?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm a sick man, eh? Oh! No, but yeah, like... People kind of fronted on Drake for that, but like for real, if you,
I don't think they understand.
They
that.
Don't understand.
That's actual it's heavy over there, right?
West yeah, Indians for sure. Are
they're heavy like, yo, you trying to be fake Jamaican? You're, you know, no. and then they're like, they don't realize that yeah, if you Toronto.
Grew,
is,
you grow
yeah.
up around a lot mad of West Indians. People. Yeah, West yeah. Indians, and this the way people speak in Toronto is crazy, and they you know, like yeah. the guys and the still and like they have these just words that you don't hear anywhere else, because it's a crazy fusion of the like, Caribbean but also like Indian population,
mm-hmm.
like and it's like they're like the mix in Toronto is like the most multicultural city yeah, in North
it's
America.
It's a mix of like a little UK African too.
Exactly.
Like, yeah, yeah.
Right. So the UK is kind of the Commonwealth, because Canada is a Commonwealth country. We still got the Queen on our coin and stuff like that. Right. So mm-hmm. we got a little bit of the UK. And then so all the islands have all their own little things. So you get this big melting pot of slang.
Right.
And the way that Drake's talking, he's not trying to be a fake Jamaican. That's actually like if you're growing up in Toronto, you grow up around those kind of things.
Yeah.
Those accents and just the way people talk. And then you move there and it's just like, I don't know. I think people take that a little bit overboard. They just like when you start to travel, you just realize like everywhere's got their own little flavor.
Right.
And ultimately it's communication, you know, like some people look at it as like playing a role, but like, if you live in somewhere for long enough, you're going to start talking like the people there, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? And it's a way to communicate, and you want to feel at home and all this other stuff. Like, I don't think, like, he never tried to put it on, but it just, like, that's who he grew up around, yeah. you know, and the people the company keeps around him, you know, so.
Did you ever know Drake, or did you ever?
No, like, only one time we had a gig. Like, basically, when I moved to Toronto was when the Drake rocket ship took off. So, mm-hmm. like, it was like, whew. And, like, because, like, you know, DJ Respect for Toronto, he used to DJ for him, and Junior Flo used to do some stuff with him, who's with Keys of Crates now, I think, or something. Like, he was trying to get on for, and I knew of his stuff, and he put out that song with Trey Songz, I think Irreplaceable Girl yeah. or something. Mm-hmm. Like, he had some stuff brewing, and like, I remember hearing, I wasn't really, like, really checking for him, pretty much until the song I'm So Fly came out.
Oh, I love that record.
Yeah, which was this record by this guy named Paige, mm-hmm. and Paige had this record, and it was like a dope club record, kind of like sort of synthy.
Or I might be thinking,
it's like the I'm Still Fly.
I know what record you're thinking about.
It's a sample. It's exactly. kind of like a sample of I'm Still Fly.
Of the Big Timers.
Yeah, Big Timers. Yeah.
And then Drake sang on it, and he sang on autotune, and it kind of sounded dope.
Yeah.
And then Drake did a freestyle over the Paige beat. And it's funny, if you go back and listen to the freestyle at the start of it, he says, oh yeah, this is that, I'm just doing this little singing thing. It's just something I tried here for the first time or something. He's like, I'm just messing around, you know? And you're like, that is yeah. what took him right. up, you know? And then Best I Ever Had came right. out. So I basically moved to yeah. Toronto, like, basically the summer that Best I Ever Had came out. And so, like, he took it there. He basically went on tour with Lil Wayne when I moved to Toronto, so I didn't really catch him around. So mm-hmm. that's fine, you know. Like,
yeah.
You know, he just, like, it's crazy to see what Drake has become and everything. And it's
how long were you in Montreal before Toronto?
5 years. Yeah.
And what sparked that move?
I started DJing at the Drake Hotel, so that was this.
Drake.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
a coincidence.
Coinkadink.
And Drake yeah. happens to be performing in Vegas tonight.
So Halifax, again, this connection to Halifax, there's a bunch of people working at this new hot hotel club spot called the Drake Hotel. And it was like, I don't know, it's like sort of like a boutique hotel. You've been there before?
No. Maybe?
Okay. It's sort of like in the West End. At the time, it was like further west than anyone was going downtown. But it was like this cool, super cool, forward thinking. Like, they had all these kind of cool acts coming through, crazy techno acts from Norway to arts, super art installments, all these crazy things. But there was a lot of people from Halifax that worked at the bar there. And it was popping, but the people at the bar were like, yo, we got to get Scratch Bastid in here for a real party. You know, like, they were so like,
they put in the word.
They picked me up. And so at the bar, like, they were like, but at the first time, the talent booker, like, wasn't believing it. He was like, oh, who is this? Like, we don't need to book. We have all this awesome, crazy talent coming in. And so the people at the bar had a bet with him about liquor sales. They're like, they're like, okay, yeah, you got, like, they're bugged him enough. They're like, he was like, no, man, we're not going to sell anything at the bar. They're like, look, Nova Scotians drink, and we do. It's a big thing. And yeah. he's like, they're like, we'll bet you, you know, you don't break $2,000. If you, you know, they made a fun bet, right? And so, like, they brought me down for a party, and we turned it out. And sold like $6,000 worth of booze or whatever at this bar. And, like, then it was like, oh, they were like, oh, this is a real thing, eh? So, like, you know, I sat around and, like I hung out for the weekend. It was a super cool bar. And then I started doing a monthly, and I would come down and take the train, and it really built some steam.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, Montreal was cool to me. But there was this kind of like, I had kind of done what I wanted to do, and I kind of felt a bit stagnant there. And the Toronto thing was like, really, like, the shows were like, I was getting so much out of the shows, because now I could start to play reggae and dancehall. I really felt like the
over. Yeah, like, what's the difference in the scenes? Like, is Montreal more a little like EDM more?
Yeah, well, especially at the time when I moved there, like, I remember when I moved there, like, that's when MIA broke. So, like, and Montreal is kind of, it's like, people go to Montreal in their 20s to sort of explore them, like, do whatever the fuck they want. Like, right. it's like kind of like,
because of the drinking. It's like 18 to drink six. Like,
yeah, kind of, and it's the French English thing. So mm-hmm. it and it's just sort of like
feels worldly or something.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and you can kind of go and like get away in Montreal a little
it
bit.
It feels like a baby Europe sometimes
it
when
is,
you're there.
Yeah. It's I would say it's the most European feeling city in North America.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, the party's late and people like it's got this little sort of like, you know, you're separated from things a little bit. It's like a different country almost.
Mm-hmm.
Feels like, and they tried to become a different country a couple times.
Yeah,
Quebec, like the French part of Canada, trying really, to separate.
They were
like this close. Like,
they'd be feeling themselves sometimes. Like they think they're like.
And honestly, over time, that wore on me a little bit. I speak French as well, and it's something I learned because the part of Halifax, like Nova Scotia, like it's part French. There's parts that are French,
mm-hmm.
but like, I wasn't from Quebec, and it's not, and I don't feel any type of way about it, except it would just, I could see that like I wanted to build more and it wasn't really happening, and I wasn't really like building, like contributing to the scene in the way that I wanted to. And so when I started doing Toronto and I felt this like movement and I felt people really getting behind me and like loving what I was doing, I was like, damn, I'm kind of getting more love down here.
Mm-hmm.
And that was going good. And then that summer I met my wife. And so she was living in Toronto at the time, but she's originally from Halifax. I didn't know her, and I met her in Halifax over the summer. We linked up, and then she went back to Toronto, and then I had still had the monthly gig going down, so I'd go down and stay for a couple of days, and like we had this little long distance relationship thing going on, and then I was like, okay, like all my chips are on Toronto, and I'm gonna move to Toronto.
So how long is the travel from?
It's a 5-hour train ride. It's a 1-hour flight. Yeah. Sometimes it's
50 minutes.
Yeah, it's a short flight, but okay. I kind of like taking the train. Like, we went downtown to downtown, and I'd prep my songs and stuff, like it's just chill, you know. So, so I'd do
probably
that.
Cheaper too, right?
It's cheaper too, yeah, for sure. Man, never underestimate that.
That's
that.
Usually the motivating factor.
Yeah, exactly. You're like, no, it is, man.
I like, you know, there's Wi-Fi and it's a nice view and everything like that.
But man, like, I mean, I don't know if this is something you guys have talked about on road before, but. You know, budgeting as a DJ is a really important part of the whole thing,
definitely.
Man.
Yeah.
You know, it's fun and all, and it's, you know, the money comes pretty quick, but like, you got to budget that shit.
Yeah.
And really, what was the value? Like, I'm thinking, looking at the train ticket and saving, may I save $200? You know, even if you're getting paid a few G's or something like that, you might be like $200, it adds up over time. And then I'm like, what am I really gaining out of taking the plane?
Mm-hmm.
I still got to take a cab to the thing and then wait in security and then fly and land. And then I got to take the cab into the city. And I'm like, I'm really gaining like an hour.
Right.
And I'm kind of going through all the stress. Well, then I'm emptying my pockets and getting on. I'm like, let me just go on the train.
Right.
You know what I mean? You could arrive at the train 5 minutes before it takes off and hop on, no security.
Got a point.
The hardest shit ever was when I first started traveling on the road. Like, no one schooled me on like getting reward points.
Yeah.
And then just like yo, when you get to this city, you want to go this way, you want to do that or whatever like that, like, and then you just start picking shit up, and then it's just it really is like traveling like that, being on the road can really fuck you up if you're not like really
well. If you have these inefficiencies, the little tiny mistakes grow and grow and grow. So like you're like, oops, like this small error can cost you big time once you start like doing more shit.
I remember I was traveling for like a year, and then I didn't have any reward. I wouldn't like had any reward points. And someone was like, yo, are you an idiot? I get like, you know.
Yeah. All you had to do is remember a 9-digit number. Bro.
I feel like if there was a train that get left out of Nevada, we would all be taking the train a lot more.
I wish there was a train to LA.
Yeah. Like,
that'd be amazing.
Well, they've been working on that.
Yeah.
A couple of years.
Overseas is amazing. Like traveling train around Europe and stuff like that in Germany. It's just like a chill way to travel.
Yeah,
I feel like also like just in your, like, you know, you're sitting on a plane, it's like, it can be real tense and shit, you know what I mean? Like, it's just like, and people get mad, and on the train everyone's just sort of like, you know, moving a little slower. Like, it's, I mean, or Japan, you're zipping around, it's crazy.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah.
I think that's like a bigger, longer conversation for another podcast, but like
the train rides.
The train. Yeah.
Hey, so how did the barbecue start? Because, you know, you moved to Toronto for your wife, right?
Yeah. Shouts out to my wife.
But you've been doing the barbecues a long time.
Yeah, right? So actually the first barbecue that I ever did was in Halifax, like, way long ago. But it was just like a one-off kind of funny thing I wanted to do.
Yeah, yeah.
But at the time where I was playing, like, three nights a week or something like that, and I was doing all these shows, but you're playing 10 to 2. you're always playing in dark clubs. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I was sort of like, I'm a huge music fan. Like, my taste in music is, like, extremely wide. And I thank hip-hop for that because I got into all this, everything that they sampled, and then eventually just started liking that music itself, and then boom, 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 boom. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, and mixtapes used to be an outlet for me. But then I'm like, okay, like, and people would be like, yo, I love your mixtapes. Why don't you play some of that at the club? I'm like, because it kind of doesn't really fit there, some of it. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, so, how am I going to play some of this stuff I want to play in a public environment, but still, like, share these other vibes that, like, not just in a dark club on the weekend or a weeknight. So I was like, all right, well, let's do, like a jam. Like, in my mind, it's basically like the summertime in the LBC video or something like that. Like, it's just like a jam on a Sunday or whatever. It's
when was the first one you did?
Like, it was probably in, like, and this was, like, before I even thought of it as, like, a
day
bigger
part.
Thing. It was just, a one-off or, like, something I did for fun, probably 2002 or 2003.
Wow.
Like, just a fun one-off little thing. Like, it was, like, and I think, like, maybe about 8 people came to, like, the early part of the day. People didn't really get what I was doing.
Yeah.
And it was just me and my homies. We were kind of hanging out with this new music. And then we ended up doing the later thing, and people came to the club later. And what I ended up doing was I took the circular barbecue, and I was just grilling, like, hot dogs for people as they came in the club. They're like, what are you doing? I'm like, you want a hot dog? You know, they just, like, this is kind of cool, you know? Like, yeah, and then we went to the club. So people, and then, like, We didn't have it fine-tuned or anything, but I just had this idea that I wanted to do this sort of, like, food party and mm-hmm. mix it with music. And that was, like, early. And then my manager at the time, you know, he's like, that was kind of cool what we did. Like, and he's like, maybe we should try to do that in Toronto. This is, like, right when I moved to Toronto. So about 10 years ago, we kind of started to actually try to do that concept. So that would have been, like, maybe, like, 5 years after that. He's like, let's try to take this to... let's try to do this as a real event.
How often do you do the barbecue? Like a year?
Last year we did 9.
9?
Yeah. And that was probably our most. And the previous year probably, I think,
from
7.
From what, like, one, what month? Well, like, you mostly during the spring, summer?
Yeah, time? Exactly. Yeah. Well, and we always do the Redbull 3 style. It's like the official Redbull 3 style, like, after party. Like, mm-hmm. the day after, it's like, so we're doing the first one this year will be in Taipei. And mm-hmm. then South by Southwest.
Are you doing one in Taipei?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
How
that
dope
lineup
is
crazy, by the way.
What are you going to barbecue out there?
You know? Chicken feet?
Are you importing, like, fucking...
I bring my sauce. So, typically what I do...
Oh, yeah, you have your own sauce.
Yeah. Typically what I do is...
Yeah, he's feeling himself.
Yeah.
He's got his own sauce.
Talk that shit, Scratch.
Yeah, it's a... Well, the sauce... I make the sauce with some people in Toronto that, like, have been making family sauce for years.
So you have it in
the
stores?
I don't have it in stores.
Oh, okay.
You got to get it from me or...
what's the website? What's the website?
Scratchbastid.com. S-K-R-A-T-C-H.
So I can get it from your website.
Yep.
Have you seen his website?
No, I haven't.
There's a lot of shit going on that website.
Oh, yeah.
We're in the process of updating. It's mad old. Even my logo has no beard on it.
You have a school?
Yeah, yeah.
What?
Scratchschool.com.
He has Scratch School.
Get out of here.
You should have called it the Bastid School.
The Bastid School. Yeah, but...
You're doing a lot of shit.
Yeah, I don't know.
A lot of cool shit.
I just like to... Like, they're all just little ideas. Again, it's sort of like when I have an idea, I just want to... I try to build on a concept. Like, mm-hmm. I try to put it in place and then, like, try to tweak it and improve it and see if it works. And you know, also with the help of my management, like, I have a real good team around me. And shouts out to Rock Paper Management, Mark and Rowley.
Nice.
And we'll try stuff, and I try to stay, like, real about it. Like, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. I'm sure I've had some failed concepts over the time, but, like, if something's coming from a good place and you want to do it for the right reasons, I think, like, if I believe in it, you can make it happen. And then eventually it's you weigh the cost and the benefit of it. How much time is it taking, and what am I getting out of it? Or
I swear, man, I hate a motherfucker with a team, man.
I love the apron.
I hate a motherfucker.
The apron
with a team.
The apron he be wearing sometimes. Yeah. Shit is hard as fuck.
I hate that.
Can Never, you buy the apron on the website?
Never. You got a team?
I don't have a team. I'm
yo D.
I'm,
you
I'm,
got a team?
I'm my only team. Me
gotta,
myself and
gotta
I.
Get yourself
one
a
man
team,
army.
Bro. Get yourself a team.
I'm gonna get myself a team.
Well, look. Well, here, let's talk about that for a second. I do want to talk about it because I. Cause like
he did
like,
some Golden Globe shit. He's like, I gotta give a shout to my team.
I know.
Like, thank God.
I know. But listen, I seriously, and this is like, I guess would it be my third iteration of managers. I had a manager maybe for like 1 year in mm-hmm. Halifax, and then I had another manager that I worked with mostly in Montreal, and then after I moved to Toronto, now I've been working with these other guys for 4 years basically. But I do think like somehow if you can just even just delegate jobs to even if it's your homies or something like that,
yeah.
it can just really, really benefit to have somebody in place that can help you with something.
Definitely.
Whether it's helping you book flights, because like there is so much to do, and it's like you could be like, I mean, even now I could be even working more efficiently at certain parts of my thing, you know, mm-hmm. like and you can only delegate so much. But like I do think that for DJs out there trying to level up or something like that, like don't be afraid to pay someone a little bit to help that happen,
mm-hmm.
because I can tell you that through management and agency, like at first sometimes you're looking like, oh man, this person taken from me. But like, if they're worth their weight, they're gonna make that money back and then some.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, because it's always, I find especially with bookings, it's like if I paint a picture and I'm trying to sell it to you, and we're friends, it's like, or if I paint a picture and I'm trying to sell it to you, I'd paint it. I'm emotionally connected to that, and it's like, it's hard for me to give it a price because I'm like, I like it.
Well, you're not being realistic about the market value.
Yes,
because you made it.
And yeah, you're
yeah.
right there.
Yeah,
but if you give it to someone and then they say, oh well, and you know, they're having a conversation about the thing I did, and they're like, obviously this is worth this, right? This mm-hmm. is what it's worth, and they tell you why. It's always easier for someone else to say it's worth this, even if you know you're worth. Sometimes it's hard for you to say it, or maybe that's just for me personally. Can be hard for me to sometimes say like I'm worth this, even though like there's an opportunity cost right. over here and there, and this person I could be making this over here, and you know what I'm saying.
What kind of a negotiator are you usually for yourself? Because the kind of when I negotiate, I end up lowballing myself.
Yeah,
right.
Mm-hmm, me too.
Because to me, I'm just happy to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
just happy to be here.
I'm exactly. just humbled to do it. And then if mm-hmm. I ask for anything more, I feel like an entitled piece of shit.
You exactly. know? And I think that's important to realize that that's a characteristic of yours. Yeah. And then to put someone in place, and it's not like a gatekeeper, but certain things. And then look, I have times where I'm like, okay, look, this has to be, this is worth doing no matter what it is, so we're going to do it, you know? And there's a sliding scale, you know what I mean? And but it helps to have someone else there to help slide that scale.
Yeah, yeah. I think just working together, like, I think sometimes DJs don't want to work together. Like, they're just afraid, like.
They want to just for self.
Yeah.
Just go out for themselves.
I mean, there's a competition, too, because it's just kind of like, yo, like, if I helped you with something and then you help me with something and then I blew up, you're kind of like, well, how come that shit didn't help mm-hmm. for me? Mm-hmm. And then mm-hmm. there becomes this thing of like, well, your career is moving more than mine. And mm-hmm. I just think like, even with this podcast, us just even teaming up and working together more and just like communicating more, I think it's kind of helped us in our DJ careers a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Even with
yeah.
the marketing and how we approach marketing and view marketing and stuff like that.
It's yeah. way different.
Yeah, yeah. I just think it's definitely important to level up with a crew of dudes.
For sure,
you know?
For sure. And it's like this, like if you look at successful people in like in hip hop or in music, like the people that team up and work together,
yeah.
like, you know, you look at like Rockefeller or something like that, or even like Cash Money or something like that. Like these people like have like teams in place. Like, I mean, bad shit happens too, like whatever. But like you look at the teams that they assemble and you're mm-hmm. like, damn, like they there's a lot of strategy going on there. And even in the DJ world, you see it happen. And some things have their time and they fall apart and everything. Like, again, like I say, I'm on my third set of management or whatever, and things have just changed every now and then.
I've been through probably two stages of managers.
Mm.
But in your case, going through three stages of managers,
mm.
ultimately, what were the main problems? And do you think it was a repeat? Was it you or was it, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like
sure.
Where you're kind of the blame because you're allowing certain things to, you're yeah, not well, speaking up on certain exactly, things and whatnot.
Well, that, it kind of comes to that. Like you're inevitably going to come with something's going to happen where you're like, you disagree on something or right, something's right. going to happen. That happens in everything. And I think playing sports prepared me for that shit. Like yeah. sometimes you're going to throw the ball out of bounds at the worst time possible. And you're going to lose. And someone's got to take responsibility for that.
Right.
And things like that happen. But then, like, if you're working with someone that can't take responsibility for their errors or something like that, mm-hmm. or they have characteristics that don't gel with you, because remember, they're representing you. So if they have some characteristic that it, you think you don't look, you think is bad, and then they have it, you, maybe that's going to grind over time. You know what I mean? Like all these things, it's like, it's just like any relationship. Like, you know.
Are you one of many DJs that your managers manage?
I'm the only one, actually.
You're the only one.
Of DJs. That they work with a few other artists as well.
Okay. Have you ever worked with a manager that had multiple DJs?
Yeah, my last manager had a few DJs. Yeah.
Did you feel like it was a problem of them actually, like when you got a gig, was it like, oh, I'm going to spread this gig over to all the guys now?
It was kind of varied enough that I wasn't really competing with people in the same house.
Right.
But there would be times where I'd be like a little bit jealous of like, oh, like let's work on me.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know, not like, not, you know, and yeah. So, yeah.
Well, how do you get to a point? How do you think you get to a point where you just need, when you can get a manager that like really just focus on your own shit?
You know what? Like in my current situation, like the guys I work with, like it actually started playing basketball. Like I played ball with my main manager, Mark, and we played ball and we're like Stockton Malone, man. Like it was, everything was clicking.
Right.
You know? And we're like, oh shit.
Speaking my language. I love this.
You kind of have this like this sixth sense and I know where you're going to be in this. And like he started managing a few bands and I was like, oh, cool. And he started getting like he started making some opportunities for them. And I saw like how he like made opportunities for them. And I'm like, like I'm not really having that in my situation. Amongst other things, there were other long-term things that graded over time that got worse and certain things and personal stuff. But, and it was sort of like, okay, I was kind of like starting to decide I have to look to something else because I decided I got to get out of this situation. And I'm looking over here and I'm like, okay, like he's doing really cool stuff here. And like, I was like, okay, well, and like we were always hanging, playing ball. And I'm like, we got a good chemistry. So we work well together. Mm-hmm. And then I'm like, okay, well, let's just start working together.
You know? Yeah.
Like, and so like I ended up for a bigger reason, left my other manager, and then like eventually we're like, all right, let's, why don't you want to manage, like maybe like one day after basketball, like you want to manage me, like let's go, let's do this.
Is there a transition period where you know you're gonna lose some gigs, or you're gonna like there's gonna be a moment where the money's gonna go down a certain degree, but you have to kind of rebuild it back up, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly, because like there's gonna be a period where like you stop working and unless you're booking for yourself, and it was like a 3-month period,
and then your old manager might, if he's petty enough, or he might try to like blackball you, or like destroy some of the relationships that you have, and like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it could happen. I mean, anything can happen, right? Like it all depends on how you handle the situation. And but I think that knowing that anything can happen, don't let the fear of that something could happen ruin the opportunity to work with someone and build something. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, because it can be a great thing. Don't let the idea of like lose, like not everyone's gonna rip you off, and even if someone is gonna like do a bad thing for you or rip you off, like you have the choice to pull out of it if you're smart about how you move, like agreements you have, you could sign contracts and things like this, you know what I mean? Like you can choose to make it not as bad, like you can it's whatever position you put yourself in. And I think that some people like fear of the worst and don't, and then that holds them back from even potentially becoming better, you know what I mean?
Yeah
But
back to the barbecue. Do you guys mostly do it in Toronto,
or is it
spread out through different cities?
It started in Toronto,
and then do you want to do it like a do-over thing where it just switches in cities, or not really?
Well, I mean, it's we only do one a year in Toronto. So last year we did Krakow, Poland for the Redbull 3-Star. We did South by Southwest. We did Toronto, Vancouver, Calgary, Edmonton.
Oh, so it does move around. Yeah.
It's been moving around for the last 6 years.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. You're doing South by Southwest this year, yeah?
Yeah, for the second time. Dope. So
then we might have to fly out.
Yeah. How is that?
I love Austin. Tight.
What?
Been to Austin, never been to South by Southwest.
My God. Yeah, South by is amazing.
It's different now, though, right?
Yeah, it's always changing. The first one I went down to was in like 2006. When Houston was like popping, like Paul Wall, Slim Thug, like it was crazy. Wow. So, because I toured with like underground rap cats. This guy Josh Martinez and this other guy Sleep, who's from Seattle, and we used to drive around the states in like a white van, and I'd make like $250 in a month, and like, you know, like it was like sleeping on wherever you could sleep. But that taught me how to like budget and shit like that, you know? And also taught me, like, I'd see artists like supporting themselves and building fan bases. And I'd see these guys go to some random ass town in Denton, Texas or something and have like 300 people come to their show. I was like, how'd you do that? You know? And it's mm-hmm. like learning the value of like finding the, go where you're loved. You know that, that saying, you know, it's, yeah. It's true. Mm-hmm. And,
yeah, I don't know. I don't know where to go. That's going to be hard to, I'll just stay here for now, but yeah. I got to figure out where to go.
What's the next destination?
I feel like I'm getting mad inspirational here. On the road. We ended up going to South by Southwest, and I was like, oh, man, that was super cool back then. I mean, some people feel it got corporate at a point, but ultimately I feel South by is one of those, you know, it's one of those anchor points for art and music in America every year. Like, you're going to see a great mix of people from across the country. And then as a music fan, you never know what you're going to see, you know, and there's tons of shows you can go check out, and you might catch Kendrick playing on a street corner. Like you might, you know, not busking or something like, but on a crazy, like you might just be playing a show outside.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I saw UGK play when Pimp C was still alive there. I saw Ghetto Boys, Ghetto Boys and Ultramagnetic MCs in one
Get
show.
Out of here.
Yeah.
Damn, man.
All the Ghetto Boys. So like Scarface, Willie D and Bushwick, they had an amazing show, you know? Mm-hmm. I saw David Banner there play at Fader Fort, and he, you know, like these are all just moments of South by Southwest that David Banner played at 3 p.m. and it was like the crunkest thing I ever seen. Yeah. And Manny Fresh was his DJ unannounced. Manny Fresh was just there wearing some t-shirt he bought at like Urban Outfitters or something. It said like, if I don't remember it, it didn't happen. I was like, man, you just roll out of bed wearing that, bro. Like you wore that out of the house.
So if we were gonna check out Scratch Bash's barbecue,
yeah,
which one would you recommend? Toronto,
the Toronto one. I mean,
when do you do that one?
Look, I love doing it everywhere, but the Toronto one is very special. Like we've been doing it now for this will be our 8th year.
Do you do it on OVO Fest weekend?
No, I do it 2 weeks before Caravan.
Big tings, man.
This is like August,
together. July, August?
Yeah, July. This is like the third week of July.
Yeah.
It's Caravan funny. Is crazy, right?
Usually.
Yeah, Caravan is the first week of August.
OVO weekend is usually the last weekend of July.
Well, it's same weekend as Caravan. So it would be like the first week in August.
Damn.
Yeah.
I have to make a trip out there, yo.
Yeah.
What's the vibes like, man?
Well, the Toronto one now, I mean, we got like... You know what's funny, like talking of like random girls or whatever, there's this one girl I remember when I first moved to Toronto.
Yeah.
There was I saw this girl on the street and she said, "Hey, are you Scratch Bastid?" And I was like, "Yes." You know. And she's like, "I just want to say," and this was like I'd been doing my barbecue 2 years. She's like, "I go to your barbecue every year and it's my favorite event of the year."
Wow.
And she just stopped me and said that on the street and I was like, "I love you." Like, thank you. And like that was a moment where I was like, "Oh shit." Like this is becoming something that people go to. They make time for it and they go to it.
Right.
And that makes me want to dedicate more to it because I realize there's
how important it is.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's saying a lot when you're in the same city as Caravana.
Like, yeah. But you know, Toronto's a big enough city. Like I feel a couple of things. I feel like it's big enough for everyone to eat, and I'm really inspired by the people like the Caribbean community because those people know how to throw parties, man.
Definitely.
And they know how to promote, and they know how to like sell tickets, and they have a community that supports them. You know, like there's this whole thing. Like I'm kind of like, I don't mean to be a dick, but I'm kind of like anti guest list in some way. You know what I mean? Like I want my homies to come in and stuff like that, but like also like. I like to keep tickets at a low enough price where it's like, come on, man, like just put a 20 on it or something like that early if you want to come, you know.
You don't want the pretension of the guest list kind of like the...
Yeah. And like I keep beer really cheap. Like we had beers were like $6 or something Canadian, like, you know, like, like it's sort of like if we want this thing to run, you got to respect that we're putting a lot of work into it.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And every now and then someone might not be able to afford it or like, you know...
How much are tickets?
We start now, I think, like in Toronto, the early birds are $30.
$30?
And then we kind of move up.
That's like, that's like eight US dollars.
Oh, man, the exchange rate.
I thought it was the same shit. I was like, what the fuck?
Bro, I'm trying to just shit on the Canadian dollar.
Exchange rate is crazy.
No, we love Canadians here. They give us the masterpiece of ketchup potato chips.
No, you guys are down like 20%.
No, 150 American bucks get you 200 Canadian right now.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like
holy shit.
Yeah, yeah. It's so it's a good time to be, for me to be making beers US
like
dollars,
beers right? Like $3.50.
Shouts out to Technics.
Yeah,
oh,
nice.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So do you team up with any barbecue spots in Austin while you're out there? Because that's a big barbecue city.
Yeah, so we teamed up with Slab. So Slab is they're dope. Yeah, slow low and banging.
Oh wow! Another great name on this podcast.
Right,
slow low. So you use your sauce for
the slab
for the barbecue for the slab.
For the slab, we did. So I would do a jerk sauce. So we did a jerk.
I know. I looked
sandwich.
On your website. I'm gonna order it. Tonight.
before you order this sauce,
use promo code Road Podcast for 20% off your order.
Before you order this fucking sauce, okay?
Yeah.
That his team is gonna package and ship you
with stickers. Throw an apron in for good Neva over there. With your face on.
We gotta figure out if this sauce is something that he was like, yo, I really love my sauce. I'm gonna package my sauce. And his team was like, yo, that's a great idea. We're gonna help you do it. Or if it was a thing where people were like, yo, your sauce is so dope, you need to package it.
Well, it came, it's really a collaboration with
did you have something to do with the sauce, putting the sauce together?
Did you test it? Like, did you go?
Did
you get the final approval?
That's how, so these guys make like 20 different sauces, and I kind of went in, and I'm like, okay, these are my faves, and we're gonna work like this. So it's a collaboration. It's a Bastid BBQ.
It's a collab.
Yeah, it's a collab. All they got the whole bottling plant and everything like that, and they make dope sauce. And it's Caribbean. It's like Guyanese, which if you know your Caribbean, like Guyana and Trinidad is like, they kind of hate each other, but they're kind of the same people. Like,
yeah.
You know, like from afar, you're like, you guys have the same accent and you eat the same food. And then from close, they're like, nah, man, we're so different, man.
That's crazy.
Not Guyanese.
So what is it? What kind of sauce is it? Like a
we call it pepper sauce. It's like a Scotch bonnet, so it's like habanero, but Scotch bonnet is like and the peppers come from Jamaica.
It's like a jerk then, like a jerk sauce.
No, well, I make a jerk too, so I make two hot sauces. One is just a regular. Well, the other one has a bit more garlic than number one. The garlic one is my favorite personally, but also the jerk sauce is amazing. And the jerk, we just actually import it from Jamaica. Like it's actually straight.
How many bottles of this shit are you moving, man?
How much are they?
I'm looking at it, man.
$10 each.
Got the Bastid hot sauce 3-pack for $19.99.
Ooh, that's a good package.
Got the Bastid jerk sauce, Jamaican rub and seasoning for $7.99.
Let's put it this way: I'm not ready to retire from DJing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
this looks good though, man. I'm about to try this jerk.
I stand behind those sauces 100%.
Yeah.
Look, ultimately,
what a fucking promo ad that was.
I can't believe this dude is slinging fucking barbecue sauce.
You got the garlic hot sauce for $6.99. I'm about to do this garlic hot sauce right here for $6.99.
What else is there in that thing?
I mean, you got
the basic
apron.
I'm a big fan of the apron, by the way.
That's sticker 3-pack.
Fucking marketing strategy there.
Yeah. Yo, I'm not really. Yeah. I'm not feeling the. I'm got not the, feeling
the women's tees as well. Got some nice women's tees.
You might need to reshoot those women's tees, my man. They're like MySpace pictures.
I know, man. Yo, for real. I'm in the process of. My team is in the process of updating my website.
Oh my god!
Look, nobody uses CDs no more. Let's get some. Get some USBs going on there,
man.
I'm just that's you.
I'm a good friend. No, for sure. You know how websites go.
I might have to DM you and let you know how this sauce is, man.
We might have to do like an on camera review of the sauce.
Yeah, yo. Well, seriously, you know, it's funny you
I'm
say
a big
that.
Jerk chicken.
Uh-oh.
I like how that's the last one.
Where's my bag at?
Hey, yo, man.
We don't even have a vessel for the sauce though, do we?
Man. $12.50 for my a CD,
is,
yo.
My bag is mad heavy.
He's got the Soul Sister stand-ups CD over here for $12.50. Yo, that's kind of expensive, yo.
Yeah, there's nice packaging on that CD, bro.
Here's the craziest part. We had chicken earlier. We should just fucking waited.
For the sauce, right?
Oh, my gosh. Should I run back? Should I go get another four combo? Yeah. So
I brought my favorite sauce, which is my number two, garlic.
Let's see this.
Do we have any, like, spoons?
No, I'm not gonna. Come on, man.
I'm hitting that
right now. Chetty's.
I'm Mexican.
Yeah, shout out to Chetty's. This is my sauce gang.
Yeah. Damn.
His sauce team.
Nice packaging.
I like the
yeah, and shout out to my graphic design team.
Oh, there we go.
There you go.
Yeah, I'm not feeling this portion of the podcast.
Wow, okay. Number two hot sauce.
Okay.
Hey, made from scratch.
Yeah. Oh, I get it. I just got it.
You've been missing it all day.
I've been missing it all day. Pause.
Damn, this is incredible. So,
do you guys like
Yo, can you read the ad in like a Toronto? Like,
I'll read it in Nova Scotian.
Nova Scotia?
No, I like the Nova Scotia, but can you read it like in that Drake?
In that OVO?
I'll try my best.
Here you go.
Let me see. This episode of the R.O.A.D. podcast is sponsored by DJ City, eh? DJ City is a leading supplier of new music for DJs around the world.
Big man thing. Big man thing.
From time, they've been providing working DJ. I had to like make a new script. Okay, hold on. Yeah. From time, they've been blessing DJs in all the spots them.
Oh my God.
All the spots dim.
A real Toronto.
Yeah, with the biggest tunes.
Biggest tunes? Yeah. For your head top.
Yeah, for your head top. I don't think I could do the whole of that. I'd have to like rewrite it.
You have to change.
I can't freestyle.
You're basically like translating it all.
Just read it regular then.
All right. Let's hear the rest in Nova Scotia.
Oh, I can do that freestyle.
Okay, let's do that.
This episode of the R.O.A.D. podcast is sponsored by DJ City. DJ City is the leading supplier of new music for DJs around the world. Since 2001, they've been providing working-class DJs with the latest club and radio songs, including exclusive intros, remixes, acapellas, and more. Any DJ can subscribe for less than a dollar a day. You can get all the tools you need to rock a party, club, fire mitzvah, mix show, whatever. Check out DJCity.com for more info.
Hey. DJCity.com. Shake well. You can see like the little
ebony joints. So we walk in, we go to Toronto, we walk in. As soon as we walk in, what are the vibes? We get our tickets. There's just bar.
Well, one of my favorite things,
is it?
What's the limit?
The Toronto one, we had 2,200 people there last year. And we had, so the lineup. One of my favorite things about the barbecue is like curating the lineup, because it's like DJing with DJs. You're like, oh, I want to put this person here, this person here, this person here. So this
the
year
right yeah here. Yeah, leave the branding, we gotta get this
year. How did it flow? I do some stuff with a live band in Toronto called Reverse, and they're super dope, like four piece drums, bass, and we do like some covers of songs, and I had pieces, and so we had them. We had ESP, JMKM, Headspin. Shout out to Headspin, Nasty.
And there's no particular genre. Anything.
And well, that's I really want. So part of it, like, it is kind of like my style. Like, I like hip hop. It's sort of like hip hop's flavor, but like I want it. Like in Toronto, there's a lot of hip hop fans. Like Toronto has a crazy hip hop scene. Where, of course.
King of the Dots, a huge. Like,
yeah, you guys are basically the New York of Canada, pretty much, right?
Yeah, like it sounds pretentious to say that, but just that's generally what it is, you know. And I can kind of say that, I guess, because I'm not really from there, but, but like it's super strong. Like that when I went there, like I first remember going to hip hop shows in New York and in Toronto, and like they play like Master Ace B sides, and everyone would be like, oh, you know, rapping every word to like you know, whatever Born to Roll or like whatever, like Top 10 List or some shit like that, or like or they play like Black Moon like B-sides or just like album cuts, and people be like hitting walls and stuff like that, damn, like I found like this place I want to play, you know. It's like super dope. Then you got the dance hall side, like where they just ride so hard for that stuff. So they're just real passionate music people, and I think that comes from the multicultural situation, because like when you come from a background, like music is one of the things you hold on to, you know. Like my mom, like the Trini side, we would listen to, like, we would eat food and then we would like jam after, and we would just listen to like Calypso and Soca, and like, and then, you know, typically like a selection of like five songs, and then let me a Mighty Sparrow CD or something, like the Dollar Wine, and like, you know, just like a random collection, like this guy Black Stalin, and like they were just like party jam. That was that, and like you should see, like my grandmother would be dancing, like, so my grandmother, like, basically like grinding, like you should have seen my wedding, like people like, your grandmother is the shit, like your grandmother, like people like, I want to go home, Paul, but like I don't feel I can go home until your grandmother goes home, like she's kind of killing it, you know. Like I feel like Toronto has so many people like really identify with it, so when their jam comes on, they're just like, they just own it. It's part of that
yeah.
that culture. So I think that that leaks into hip hop and leaks in, you know, like, because I don't know, like a lot of those kids, like, you know, grew up on their parents like in maybe island music or something else, but then they, when they got into hip hop, they love it the same way, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like their passion for music. And I feel like that, like, from my mom's side, and my dad also liked music, I feel like that rubbed off on me. Like, I'm really, like, when I love something, like,
yeah, yeah,
I love the song, you know, yeah, get hype.
It's funny because I would have never guessed that you're from, like, you have the West Indian background.
Yeah,
it's
yeah, crazy, right? Yeah, yeah, like, yeah, I mean, she's, my mom's white Trinidadian, like, there's all, Trinidad is like, there's all kinds of crazy, like, it's just, it's all the islands have, like, I mean, I think it's almost like somewhat stereotypical, but not like offensively, that people think like oh, like, you know, all Jamaicans are black, or like all, like, mm-hmm. they think island means you're a black person or something like that.
Right.
You know, like, yeah. it's crazy mix. Like, there's tons, Trinidad has tons of Indian people, tons of Chinese people, you know.
Yeah,
like,
there's mad Chinese people.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. And Jamaica, like, you know, yeah. the Chins, like Willie yeah. Chin and all that. Like it's a thing, right? But like, and that, because for islands, it's just people on boats coming in and out. Like, it's, you know what I mean? So, but yeah, like, I don't look like my mom's from Trinidad. I agree, yeah, yeah. you know, I got a ginger beard, like, yeah, yeah. you know, like, yeah. I definitely look like Paul Murphy, but
I think it's like really amazing. Like, you talk about Nova Scotia, Montreal, mm-hmm. and all of these things, and then, you know, this Caribbean background.
Yeah,
and then
when I moved to Toronto, like, I'm like, oh damn, like,
it just kind of
yeah,
it put everything together, kind
yeah,
of right.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It, yeah. I love Toronto. Like,
it's such, honestly, when last time I was in Toronto, man, that just. Like, I was hanging out with your boy Brian, you know, mm-hmm.
and yeah. then, shout and out then your boy Brian.
We're hanging out with his boy, who's from basically, he's like an African dude from the UK, uh-huh. and then we're like hanging out with Sako D, and it's just like there's so many different races and like cultures, and the music out there, you can like mix it all, you can go in any direction, and it's just like sometimes Vegas can be very just like one lane, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. so when I go to cities like that, it's just like fucking refreshing, man.
and
it's inspiring.
It, you know, it can feel like one lane sometimes too, yeah. but like, if you play your cards right, you can definitely mm-hmm. take it in different ways, for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
You can, you know, and that's something as DJs, we got to challenge ourselves to do that.
But definitely.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's a chicken egg scenario. Is it that you don't challenge yourself, or is it that you can't?
Yeah, that could be it too. Yeah, because, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, coming back from Toronto, I was definitely inspired.
Yeah, and then you might try to put it in, and maybe it falls flat, but you know, yeah. you can always play something next. You have an emergency record.
Or yeah, I don't see it that way. When it falls flat, I'm basically like, you fucking idiot. What are you kidding yourself? What did you think you would? That was Toronto. This is Vegas. I go through that stage of myself. But,
yeah.
How was a... Go ahead. Were you going to ask? I was going to ask, you're in Vegas. You came out here to showcase the new Technics.
Yeah.
The new 1200.
Yeah.
MK7.
Yeah.
It's kind of like,
did they reach out to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah. So actually, it was a guy in the Canadian office, Rob Sangermano. He reached out to me. He's like, he liked a lot of my videos, and he also was tight with some promoter, this guy Adam from Embrace in Toronto, and he knew like Keys and Crates and those guys, and he like he was like, yeah, like you know, I had to sign an NDA and stuff, like, we got this new turntable coming out, and he brought me in for a meeting, and I went with Drastic, actually, from Thugly, and we like talked about it, and like they showed us like a prototype and everything like that. It was super cool.
How does did the prototype look very similar to how it looks now?
Yeah, almost exactly, like very close.
Yeah,
and so they were like, okay, well, we're like, normally Canada kind of gets, we don't have any, like, as far as the big brands and stuff, like, mm-hmm. we got none of the budget, you know, because like Canadian market like looks a lot to the States for stuff, yeah. mm-hmm. you know, so like the reps, we don't have any, typically we don't have many reps or whatever, right. but in this case, like, Japan is the main office, mm-hmm. and then so Canada and America being satellite offices, I guess Rob just had the idea to reach out to me, and then so I guess I responded and like hit him back and said like, and we started working on it, and it just kind of took off from there. And then like,
What were you working on? Like a marketing?
Just feedback.
So you were just testing it out.
Yeah.
Did you take it home or
no?
Just in office.
Yeah, just in office. Oh. Yeah. Well, that was the first one. The second time that we actually went to a club in the middle of the afternoon, And like we tested it out in a club and played some records on a club system, which is what you should do because you got to put it in its proper environment. And we gave him, and there were some people from Japan there. It was a pretty serious like undertaking. And then when they came time to launch it, you know, I met some people from the States, Ellison, and some, and then here I am at CES in Vegas, launching the 1200.
What's your favorite feature from the new 1200?
I mean, to be honest, it's just that it's a continuation of the series of the 1200, which is like the standard club standard turntable. I like that it's just continues to be solid. I mean, I'd say like the detachable RCAs and the detachable ground is nice. I mean, it's kind of a small feature, but like in the long run, that's one of the things that goes in your turntables. The digital pitch as well is going to last longer than the other pitch that, you know.
What do you mean by digital pitch?
It's actually, the old one is an analog slider, and this one is a digital, like
a CDJ?
It doesn't have a readout, but it's just the other one is a fader.
Yeah, yeah.
And the new one is like a digital.
It's like sequence
board. It's like a circuit board. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Yeah, and it can be changed. So when you push the button, it just changes the, when you push the times two, the plus minus 16.
Yeah.
That's, so even some of the other, I think the M5G is digital pitch too, the way that you can change it like that.
Oh. Yeah, yeah.
So I like that feature. But it looks
There's
nice.
There's been a lot of
mixed reviews.
Mixed reviews. Just be people like, yo, like, I was excited because I was just like, wow, like, I'm excited because I'm like, wow, like, now the nightclubs have like a good turntable that they can use, and they're not, and then the sound guy's not like lying to me, like, I can never get parts.
Exactly.
I can't get blah, blah, blah. And but then there's
the turntablist community. Sorry, I don't mean to cut you off.
Yeah, no. And then there's another group of motherfuckers that are like, it's a turntable. It's the same fucking thing. Like, right. And then, you know, we just spoke with XL and Impulse, and they were just saying, like, well, like, it's already a perfect instrument, number one. And, like, they changed some of the colors. They have some of these things. But he's there just like, why did they just remove the ground cable altogether and just solder the ground and all?
Internal.
Yeah.
I think that can cause problems. You never had problems with internal grounding?
No.
I never had problems with that. And I did it on all my turntables.
Man, some of them, like, I never did it in mine, but like sometimes I step on, they're like, it's internally grounded. It's like, oh, fuck. Now I don't know where the problem is. You know what I mean? Now it's soldered inside somewhere. Now I got to open the thing up. You know, like, that's what I didn't like about that. But maybe you got your flexi with the soldering or something.
I don't know. So I paid $10 and this guy did it. And I was like, all right, smooth.
Another question, because you were in the you were talking the techniques in the in the prototype stages. Mm-hmm. What was their thinking and what was the plan when they discontinued the techniques, right? And then they brought it back. And then to introduce this now, obviously they had to been working on this for, over a year
probably a few.
And then,
I don't know.
They didn't share any
No
of
one's given, no. And honestly, it's kind of two things. I think some stuff gets a little bit lost in translation.
Yeah.
Because it is primarily a Japanese country, and the Japanese English language barrier is quite thick, man. Like it can be tough.
Yeah.
And I also think it's business. Like no one wants, that's a business secret thing, right? Like no one wants to say.
Right.
But me and Kenny Dope were talking about it, and I think what happened it's hard to put yourself back in 2008 and 2009, but like that was like. I think they could probably see numbers wise that turntable sales were shrinking, and also the Technics 1200s are pretty damn indestructible. Mm-hmm. You know, I never bought M5Gs. I was like, I don't need to buy M5Gs. I got like Mark IIs that work great, and then I got a Mark III. Might have a Mark V, but like I think that they made a product that might have been too good at the time. You know what I'm saying?
It's crazy. It's like a Cadillac.
Right? It's totally,
it's a Cadillac.
Like, I mean, I think every DJ has a pair of 1200s that has never died, right?
True. Yeah.
You know? But I think they also thought, okay, but people are stopping to buy them and new kids aren't buying. And if you remember sort of like 2008, 2009, sort of the emergence of like dubstep and the EDM and you know, the turntable started fading a bit. But I feel like, you know, vinyl has made a resurgence. And, you know, it has. And then, but also I feel like house music and techno music and kids that are into like disco and rare stuff, like even that style of DJing is becoming, these kids started on controllers and started maybe, and then realizing, oh, there's something better. Like, I want to be like Larry Levan, or I want to be like Moody Man or something like that. And like that scene, like those people are dedicated. They buy vinyl and they want to play their 12 inches.
It's just not cool either, I think.
What, the turntable?
There's a cool element about being on a turntable.
Oh, yeah, it is.
And then fucking with vinyl. It's like, you know, when you're on a controller, you just feel like a freaking...
Like a robot. There's no soul to it.
Well, and there's a commitment thing, right? Like, I brought these records. I believe in these records. And that's one of the things that was always dope about bringing crates. You had to pick, you could only carry two crates unless you're Kid Capri and you had, like, you know, your team.
You didn't have a team.
Look, I don't know if my team would carry my records to gigs, all right? But, you know, like, you had to trust what's in those two crates. Like, these records got to do my work, all my work, you know?
Do you think it might go back to that?
I don't think so.
No,
I just think that the way that music comes out, because what happened was, now people get music, we all get music at the same time,
right?
There isn't a promo. There's some exclusives and some promos in the. But like, as far as the commercial releases and stuff, we all got the Meek Mill album at the same time. It all just hit the streaming and whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. So once the crowd has something on you, there's like. You need what the crowd has, which is the digital. You're not going to wait 4 weeks for the 12-inch to come back. You know, you're going to play, you know, you're going to...
Well, I think music streaming has become so... I think, like, it becomes disposable. Like, music is just not valued as much. And I'm wondering if, like, just music coming from vinyl and just parties like that...
Make you value
it's just different when you don't know... Like, you know, we've talked about this before, where the new generation is this Shazam generation. Mm-hmm. So sometimes they want to be surprised and go to a party where they don't necessarily know all the music. And not only that, having to be like, yo, it's on vinyl, Shazamming it, and then being like, oh, shit, like, I don't know about this. I just think there's going to be a point where streaming is so easy and the digital age is so easy. At some point, we're going to, like, not want...
Yeah.
It's going to change in some way. Do you know what I mean? I'm just wondering, like, where it's going to go. Because I would have never thought that the Technics would have came back. There would have been an event in Vegas with Kenny Dope.
And everyone played vinyl.
Cut Chemist. And everyone was on vinyl. For me, seeing that, I'm like, wow, like, this is weird. Yeah. But it's dope. But there are kids that are going to see this, or there are younger DJs and some of us, and we're just going to be like...
Yeah,
you know, and like Coco, DJ there. Coco plays only vinyl.
Yeah,
like I've never seen him play on a laptop. You know?
Do you think that the resurgence of the Techniques, it'll put pressure on maybe needle companies to come? Like I'm thinking about like maybe Shure.
Come back, Shure.
And if I mean, what's your needle of choice?
M447.
M447, 100%.
Do you think they like are maybe looking at Techniques and like, oh shit?
I don't know, man. I don't know.
I think these motherfuckers talked together, and then they were like basically like. You know, let's do some Nike Jordan shit. Like, let's just like cut it.
Let's disappear.
Let's break a bunch of hearts and then like come back. Cause like
you can miss them.
I feel like Techniques fans and Shure fans of the needles are hand in hand.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I think so. But you know, let's not forget Shure makes like all the microphones.
True.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think like we forget that like at the annual meeting they look at the spreadsheet and they say. Do we really need to be doing this? Do we need to be like manufacturing? Do we need to be playing for people?
But why just the M44?
Yeah, not all the other ones that nobody
but
else
But the other needles are getting made.
Are they still?
Yeah.
That's why I was just kind of like, you're intentionally trying to fuck the DJs
you know
over.
What? I didn't know that.
Stone Rock.
I didn't know that they're doing
all You go to Guitar Center right now and they have all the other needles.
SC35s.
Yeah.
Maybe they discontinued all of them and they just have a huge stock of them that no one's buying, right?
Why did the 447 only go up?
Right.
The other ones.
Why would they announce that though? Like, we're going to stop this one.
Like, fuck you, DJs.
That all of you DJs use.
We'll see. It might influence them too. But someone's going to figure out a solution. There are those JN Co's that are actually okay. I use actually Yearbook Brands. Tried them. They're pretty good.
Which one?
The JNCO.
I was looking into that. Yeah. It's good.
I can't say I played a gig with them, but your boy Brian left his needle at a gig that we did together.
You stole them?
And I took him home.
No, he was in a returner.
I took him home for some testing.
But they were actually pretty good?
It seemed like I A-B'd them and did the best test I could in my, you know, this is the whole thing. Like, you got to be in a closed environment to test that, and like, I feel like it's hard to just tell off the bat if something is like, and even with 447s, I find you had to break them in. Mm-hmm. You know, when you break them out of the box, they're shaky.
Yeah.
But then when you leave them on the record overnight, mm-hmm. or you start playing a bit more, they wear in, they break in, and then they could be, then they start to have a little bit of give. So like, I don't know, like I don't trust other people on, when it comes to that shit. Like everyone has their own, everyone moves their hand differently on a record, uh-huh. and everyone has different hand weight, and everyone has different style. So like, you gotta, I so when I tried those and I was like, damn, these do feel pretty good. Like maybe I should try to get a pair and try them out, but I've got like 14 447s on ice, just like there.
You're good. You're Pablo Escobar, just fucking like, 447.
So wait, so do you co-sign
team, me and my team got 14. Oh man, I'm sorry. Okay, that's the last mention of my team for this whole podcast.
Shout out to his team one time.
So do you do co-sign? Do you co-sign the Jinkos?
I used them for a series of like 4 minutes. I was like, I called Brian, and Brian was like, I'm like, you want your needle back? And he's like, basically I was like, come pick up your needle. And he's like, okay, cool. And then I was like, oh shit, I should try this out before I give it. So I ran downstairs and like tried. Like,
he did the Star Wars shit. He's like, oh shit, they kind of work.
Not bad. It held up to the Star Wars test.
That's hilarious. I was
I like him.
Star Rock tweeted. He tweeted the other day at Sher. He put at Sher. You better start acting right. Hashtag M447. I was like, this motherfucker.
Well, Stone is from early Twitter. He's just a ruthless Twitter user. It's like you always step like he was one of the, like him, like both the captains. They would just like they were just throw people under the bus on Twitter, or just like, you know, they were some of the first people that I saw really bashing companies or something, really like speaking that, you know it's kind of like sometimes tongue in cheek a little bit, but it's just like
they're very honest.
Yes, very honest.
They'd be all over like American Airlines and shit all the time.
Exactly.
At Delta, it's fucking crazy.
You know what they say though, the squeaky wheel gets the grease.
I've never tweeted out my like just being displeased with like a company and being I'm gonna tweet this.
I know.
I've done it before. I tweeted to Taco Bell. They fucked up my order one time and they gave me a $5 coupon.
Really?
Yes.
Jesus Christ.
My friends laugh at me. They're like, wow, you're trying to get a free meal? I'm like, well, fuck these guys. Just as honest.
Did you use the $5?
No. I was just being an asshole.
What a waste.
You got yourself a meal.
$5. You're a DJ now. You got a budget, man. That $5 is part of the budget.
It's budget. Don't underestimate budgeting.
What's your your set right now of choice? Like, what is your hardware that you like to use?
Two 1200s and a Rain 72.
Prefer that over the S9, huh?
It's close.
Yeah.
What is it about the 72 that you prefer?
I'm like, I feel like right now, like I have the S9 figured out to me,
uh-huh.
but there's potential in the 72 that I haven't totally unlocked yet. So it's kind of like the 72 is a very complex mixer.
Well, are you sponsored by Rain?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, oh, so 72. I used to be a Rain user myself, but Four Color Zach talked me into buying the S9.
But you know, I also got my S9 gratis as well. Like, so like, you know, but I'm rocking.
He uses the S9 in the secret room with no windows.
No, I got it in my studio. I got it in my studio. Yeah, I got in my studio. I got one set up with the S9 and one set up with the 72.
Okay. Two 1200s.
Four 1200s.
Oh, what are you saying? There's like potential that you have yet to figure out maybe with the 72, or just
it's a bit of a different workflow. There's a couple things I don't like, but I don't like that the loops are on a second layer. Mm-hmm. So what I've done is, and I don't use the parameter buttons much, so I have assigned the parameter buttons to be loop on, loop off, and key lock. Even though you can do key lock on the screen,
mm-hmm.
That's what I use, those parameter buttons. And I think every mixer, you should tweak it a little bit to your own personal preference. I kind of wish all mixers came with like 4 blank dumb buttons that you could just like program to whatever you want to do.
Yeah. You can customize.
Because everyone got something that they don't like about a mixer.
Right.
So
that's really smart.
I didn't like the curve feature on the 72 that you have to, like, it's on the TV, it's on the little screen, and it's not like analog.
Well, the curve is there. That's the cut-in, you mean?
Oh, yeah, the cut-in, sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But once you set it, you can set it and forget it. But the speaking of curves, I feel like the learning curve on the 72 is very steep. Like, learning curve on the S9 is steep, but not as steep as the 72. So
yeah, 72 looks very, like, a rocket.
You
got to
spend a lot of time with it. Yeah. But yeah, I'm rocking with it. I find that, you know what? I find that echo effects on the S9 super, like, strong. Like, when
they come in fast.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, I find the rain effects are, like, a little, like, nicer, but you also have to tweak them to yourself to fine tune. So I'm still spending time with it. Like, it's, I feel like it's like a big book that I'm still making my way through. It's, you know, like, what I'm saying? Yeah.
Go ahead. I've always wondered, like, when I see these, like, Instagram routines, they're becoming more and more and bigger. But when I see them doing tone play on with the pads on, like, an S9, right? Are they pre-recording a bunch of different, like, do they have one MP3 that is literally like 15 minutes of, like, different tones of the same song, and they're cueing it all, and then they got to scratch later after all those songs, and then it's
like a good question.
They're literally layering all of these songs, and then they're doing it so that they can just seamlessly push the cues and get through everything.
But they're not loading tracks in the middle of all.
No. Right? Like, they're literally editing everything so that it's just there, like, one track. And they could just space the cues out. That's my first question. And then my second question is, when I see the DJs with a sped up video, when they're, like, DJing, when they're doing the routines and it's sped up, and it kind of has that Missy, I can't stand the rain, like, kind of look, and they're kind of, like, rapping, and
it's a lower frame rate is what they do, is they take out frames.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Because I thought that sometimes when there was juggling, it was easier to do it when it's slower, and then when it's sped up, it'll just kind of, like, do you know what I mean? It'll look like it was on real time.
Right.
So that where it's like,
I think it's a frame rate thing.
Did this on, like, real time, I can't do it. But if I slow it down a little bit and then I speed it back up to the regular thing, it'll look like it's whatever.
Yeah, I think that there. I think it's a frame rate thing. I never, like, fucked with it. Like,
yeah.
Like, and like, I'd have to ask some of my video dudes that know. But I think that's like an effect that you can push, or it's a certain setting. But as far as the editing goes, as you bring up a good point, like, when I'm judging with freestyle, you got, like, how much editing is too much editing, right? Like,
right,
there has to be, like, some natural mixing thing that you're doing. But also, edits are definitely a reality of DJing in 2019. We all play edits.
Edits, would you say that edits during a time where everyone has the music, edits are the things that set us apart to a lot of DJs?
Yeah, I mean, I think like, edits do, I think the edits do set us apart. Like, yes and no. I don't think it's, like, exclusively sets us apart, but I think, like, it can, you know what I mean? But I also think, like that you can have exclusive things, and some people, like, tweak their whole set around their own edits, and some people have, like, minute long. You sleeping over there?
Nah.
Are you looking at your phone?
Yeah, man, my mom was blowing me up, so I just wanted to text her. I'm recording.
I heard that was that nose breathing, like, mom. Mom text.
It was a Darth Vader to your routine. I kept telling him, like,
I couldn't even focus on the question. I was like, shit.
And then he's like, is it me?
Was I breathing that hard?
Yeah, man.
It was like he was behind
back
you.
It up. Yeah, I know.
Damn, I didn't even realize that. That's crazy.
That's what I told you earlier. I pushed you back and I moved the
Why
mic.
Can't I hear it?
You didn't hear that?
No.
Oh, my God.
I feel like it was blowing out of your nose ring hole.
Yes. It was, right? Yes. Yo, I swear I didn't hear anything.
I think the air from the nose the nose ring hole was blowing into the fucking microphone.
On everything. I didn't hear anything. That is crazy.
Wait till I rewind that. That's gonna be amazing.
It was like some fucking freaky perverted gerbil was behind my neck. Like, breathing and shit. Oh, man. I'm just like, yeah, where is this motherfucker? Kind of
like, who's snoring over here?
Oh, man. You were, man. You were like one of those new mumble rappers on lean, just like, who goes on Instagram Live and just all of a sudden just like starts looking down. You're like, damn, did he just fall asleep during Instagram Live?
Oh, man.
Yeah. I'm like, what's crazy? Fuck?
No, it wasn't. It wasn't like. It was like.
But it was a. It was.
And you're just like, yo, what the fuck is that?
That's crazy.
Yeah. I was like, what the fuck? No way. Yeah. I thought it was never. I was like, never. I was checking his chest breathe. I'm like, it's not him. Yeah. And I'm like backing it up. Oh my god.
Like, damn. Fucking Bane, like, but like a mouse, yeah. Bane. Batman.
Oh man, sorry, fellas.
No, it's all good. It's all good. But let me, now that I can fully concentrate, let's get back to
it. Bastid was like, you know, you move to see that was him.
You said it. Do edits define us?
Well, you're saying that how many edits is too much edits, but then also I think that the train of thinking with DJs nowadays is that, you know, these edits is what, this is what's gonna set me apart, right, especially right. if I'm doing a party, if I'm doing a routine, if I can just fucking do the tone play here and then switch to this, you know, like that'll be dope, and I'm gonna be the fucking, you know, shit,
right.
You know,
right? Yeah, I mean. This is it. Like we go through this sometimes in three style, where it's like, okay, well, how much of a skill is loading a track? Mm-hmm. I don't know. Like, is that something that we judge on? You know. So, like, is it okay to have a couple tracks loaded on one so that you can jump around to the things to get your musical idea off? Mm-hmm. Is that okay? Is that less impressive? Kind of. Like, I have one routine where I do have like three songs on one, and like sometimes I feel dirty about it. And sometimes I feel okay about it. You know what I mean?
Cheater.
Yeah, exactly. But like, but sometimes at the right place, it works. And then I think to myself, if I had it on a separate one and loaded it, would I feel better about myself? I don't know. Like,
it's a delay, man.
I don't know. Like, I go back and forth with it. But I think ultimately, it's just like what comes out of the speakers,
right,
is what matters. And I used to be that way about edits. Like, I'm like, you know, screw a four bar edit, like, you know, like I come from the vinyl days where it'd be cool if you know jug the intro, or maybe you start with the end, or you start with the instrumental, then bring in the double, then you bring in the vocal, and like,
yeah, that's a lot of work. Yeah,
it is a lot of work, but like I prided myself in like, that's how you crafted, that's how you played. Everyone had the same records, how do you play? And so now you're saying everyone's got the same music, but now the edits can help you stand apart, and I think it's like we live in a crazy, and then is it, does it have to be your own edit, or do you collect all the best edits, you know? And are you making your own edits? Are you making it too easy for you, where it's just like everything is an acapella in, acapella out over a four-bar intro? Is that okay? Does that sound good? It's like, I think that like, it just depends on your own personal style. Like, everyone has a different style, and you are defined by how you play, and that is how you play. So if you choose to do those things, just remember maybe you're taken away from some other piece of magic, but maybe you got to go harder like in that section to do something that's impressive.
Right, right.
To balance that out, the other shortcuts you might be taking, because sometimes you're just downright lazy. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think it's a great time. Like, I think every DJ should learn how to use an editing, some form of editing software, whether it's Ableton or just like,
right, right.
Like GarageBand.
It's definitely vital right now.
It is. It is. Like, it's a part of DJing, and I think that's a reflection of how good technology is, because we all have it at our fingertips. Mm-hmm. You don't have to go to a reel-to-reel and cut tape to make edits, but we all play stuff that was edited too. Like we all like. I'm trying to think of something that would be. I mean, I don't know. Like, even sampling, for instance. Like, even like the 900 number or something. It's like just like a simple loop, but we all play that, and like. Or like, I don't know, I'm trying to think of just like edits, like old school Latin Rascals edits, or like tape edits or something like that, or like Danny Crivet edits or something like that. Mm-hmm, like, yeah. We like that stuff. We play those things. Yeah. So we also got to be open to just the modern version, which is making edits in Ableton and that sort of, that's just never been at our fingertips, never been so easy. So
yeah. Shit, I mean, I just look at those videos and I wonder, like, is there a code?
Well,
do you know what I mean?
Kind of. Well, see, sometimes there's this thing, okay, like tone play, like you got to do it a certain way. But sometimes people like kind of like do tone play within the tone play. Like, they take the note and pitch it down a certain amount and then play it. And it's like, at that point, it's like, I don't know. Like, is this, you're not even taking the original thing and tweaking it to a certain, you're just sort of playing the notes on pads. And then I'm just not that impressed with that. Like, I don't
But that's what I'm cool. saying. Sometimes, like, for example, like, what's something that everyone uses? Like, Eve, Blow Your Mind.
Yeah.
They'll take the beginning.
Yeah.
And they might just start, like, typing it in and fucking around with it. And then they might do, like, the xylophone from ZZ.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
Right. But in actuality, maybe it was totally different tones, and they just totally warped warped everything,
exactly, yeah.
And then they just made that noise in different tones so that they could just get pushed, the buttons pushed, which I don't think is that. It's not a bad thing to me, but then I don't know what the code is with the turntable. It's like, yo, man, you can't do that, or that's cool.
I think it's about the magic. So to me, like, if you change that pitch, you're losing some of the magic. So unless you start with what the original is and then flip the original.
Yeah.
If you're changing it already with some post-processing, you're kind of taken away from it. And then I'm like, do I really want to hear someone just like play a melody, like a chopsticks melody on two fingers?
Right.
Like, is that something that I actually want to listen to? I don't know. If you're not freaking it and flipping it and taking it from somewhere and transforming it, if you're kind of processing it so that you can play the notes separately, then it becomes a thing of like, you made that choice.
It's almost like a plastic surgery, right?
A little bit kind of thing. And then I'm like, I don't really want to hear someone just remake the ZZ melody. I want to just listen to the ZZ song.
Yeah.
Can you draw that connection in another way or something like that? Like, I don't know. I think it's a slippery slope, the tone play thing. And I think it should be a seasoning and not like the main.
But you see people like riding on that boat heavy and doing the things like I just said, like, and then, you know, trying to get the...
Yeah, for sure.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But, I don't know. I just would watch it and I'd be like, that's cool. And I'm like, what are the codes, though? Is that breaking code? Is that aligned with the turn? Because I'm not a turntablist, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like when I see guys like you or like who else? Like a Miles Medina, a Chris Villa.
Four Color Zach.
You know what I mean? I feel like you guys are in your own realm a little bit because we're kind of like... The grunts. I feel like, I don't know. Yeah, I feel like we're the grunts that, you know what I mean?
The grunts.
I don't know, because we're the working guys that hold down the fort no matter what. And I don't think we have...
you guys get busy too, though.
No, we get busy in a different way, though, I think.
Party rocking busy.
And
you guys are technical busy.
No, but they party rock as well. I mean, but I think it's the way we approach the night is different, where like we'll free ball a whole night. Do you know what I mean? Or we'll go in and we'll just like, let's see where this takes us, what crowd we're gonna read. Where I feel like if I was a turntablist, I'd have to be like, I have to perform
right
an actual thing, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And I, the way I approach, like, for me personally with routines, I treat routines like records that I'm gonna play, you know what I mean?
Right
And so like, and I like to leave most of my stuff open-ended, so, and kind of open start, so like I can just kind of slide it into here or there.
Yeah. So I was gonna ask you this: how do you approach like a regular club night? And I'm thinking like the routines are kind of like these party breaks, except you're doing it live. You're doing your tricks.
Yeah, exactly. And not every gig calls for it. You know what I mean? Some gigs just call it to rock it and add a little bit of flavor. And sometimes someone comes and they're like, I want you to do all your routines, and you're like, this isn't the time or the place.
It's just playing like back-to-back party breaks, and it's just kind of like, you know. Yeah.
And it can be a little bit like selfish. You know, you're like, this is a party. Like, it's for everybody. We want to like play music and jam out. It's not just like a performance showcase. Like, but I think that leads to another thing with DJing. I think it's important to have a balanced diet of gigs if you can, you know. If you really want to flex, like, that's what I think is great about Instagram and videos, is that's a great place to outlet for it. Mm-hmm. It's not always the best thing to do in the club. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But like, you can also promote it there, and it can help you do it in the club sometimes. Like, if you show people that this is a cool thing, and then you do it, they're like, people come up to me and request routines all the time. You know, I want to see this. But to me, that's amazing. Like, you're like, yo, I want to see you do Baby I'm a Barbecue Boss or something like that. Or I want to see you
do you do it?
Do you make, yeah. Well, I mean, if I think it's going to fit, yeah, for sure.
I'm going to request the Star Wars routine.
Now, that's a funny one, because like, honestly, the Star Wars routine is like, you can't do it in the middle of a club setting.
Yeah,
like,
you can.
Sometimes
they can get away with it. A bottle presentation, you're dropping that shit.
Star Wars. Star Wars. Star Wars.
Sounds like a great party, guys. Yeah.
Your homie comes out a stormtrooper.
I can only do it at Comic-Con.
Wearing a costume.
No, you know, and then at that point, it's like, unless it's a showcase set where, like, or, like, I might do it at the end, but, like, a time and a place for those things. But, yeah, like, and some people, like, it depends on where, what the setting is. But mm-hmm. that's why I like to leave things open-ended, because sometimes I can just choose to take this part and do it. And sometimes it's a 30-second clip. Sometimes it's a two-minute thing. Yeah. Sometimes it's a five-minute section, you know, like depending on what the party is or what the show is, right? So, but I think that one of the things that I struggle with watching three-style stuff is when the whole thing is 15 minutes of, like, it's like a full-on routine. And I get it. Like, you practice and you practice and practice to make it this tight, dialed set. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And but, like, there has to be some room in there for looking up and seeing what's going on and reacting to the moment, because that's what makes it special, when you see someone that's like in there. And when you guys say we freeball it, well, you know what, that leaves you the room to, like, when you see some crew going off to something, you're like, okay, yo, we're gonna throw this in now, and then we're gonna throw this in. Mm-hmm. And you're gonna take it to this level that if you had planned it out straight, you would have never gone there. Maybe the party goes in a direction that you didn't think it was going to go, where you're like, oh, damn, it's this type of party. Oh, we're going here, you know? And then boom, like, and that gives you the ability to take it higher than if you say, I'm going to play exactly this the whole time. So that's a really important skill in DJing, in my opinion. And, but how do you show that skill in a 15-minute, like, three-style set, you know, that's a world championship that you've been rehearsing and practicing? Mm-hmm. How do you come across that? It's a tough one, you know? But I feel like there are people that that have done and can do it. I mean, and I think, like, Puffy was a really good example of, like, a guy that can, like, flex a little bit and decide to stretch some section out or go here or go there. I feel like
he got busy,
and I feel like he's a DJ that it can go this way or that. Like, I thought that was a really strong skill of his. Is a strong skill of his.
What do you feel about I remember we had an episode where we were talking about scratches, like DJs who just scratch.
Yeah,
I don't see it as much. But no, I think at that time we had just tons of videos of people just scratching the you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and it was just like, all right, we get it. Like, you can scratch, you're amazing, and it's just like nonstop, just scratch. And, you know, at the time we compared it to flair bartending, where it's kind of like flair, yeah, that's really
the flair. I see what you did there.
Where it's just kind of like, yo, like,
oh, that was not planned, by the way. Yeah. Okay. You made your own joke. Yeah. He said flair.
But then, and then we also kind of like, we also said, well, it was just like ego stroking yourself a little bit.
Yeah.
You know what
I
mean? Where it's like kind of like selfish, where you're like, you know, like, look at me, look how good I am, and look. And then
the word I use is masturbatory.
Yeah.
You know, like,
that's what I compared it to. Remember?
Yeah, I'm masturbating. Like, you're like, look at my, like, big cock.
No, it's just like watching someone put oil on their dick, and they're just like putting oil on their dick, and they're filming it, and they're just showing.
I can,
like,
picture it right now. Yeah.
Whoa!
But it's just they're just like, look at my shiny dick. Look at my shiny dick. Look at the oil on my dick. And we're just watching that, and we're just like, wow, yeah, it's shiny. Yeah,
But I know what you mean. And, and I'm all for, like, the, like, practicing your patterns and stuff like that. Yeah. And I think there's a place, but I feel like that's sort of like, that's what you can do in the dojo. But then when you take it out, like, you have to apply it to something greater than just that. Mm-hmm. Because that is just, it's like a video game or something like that. Or it's like this, there's no application outside, like, especially like the looper stuff where people are scratching over, like, just like a, brand, and then just like it's like, it's cool to practice it, but there's no real, like, musical application of that. Like, to me, taking back DJ Premier or something like that, like, that's the musical, that's, he's being musical, but it's like, someone might scoff at some of the patterns he's doing, but, like, the application, there's a real world application to those.
It sounded so good with the song, and then with whatever he was scratching the phrase, it just,
there has to be a way that you communicate. So it, like, that's something you can do and practice, and you get your patterns, but where are you going to take those patterns? What are you going to apply them to? How can you pick the right beat to play at the right moment and make that a cool time. Because you can, I do sometimes get up and scratch a little bit here and there on lives just to flex and then move it somewhere else.
Yeah, yeah.
But like you have to have some higher purpose of what you're doing than just that. It's a good practice. I Awe and Fresh are great tools to practice with because they mirror your movements, you know. And then when you watch like Hubert or D-Styles cut those things out, like you're like, Jesus, like it's crazy.
I'm trash.
They also choose cool beats to do it over, you know. Like D is really musical.
I like the awareness of like every four bars, the pattern changes. Yeah. I'm doing something different with the scratch,
right?
But there's just dudes that just go on and on. Like they use the whole minute of Instagram video to just be like. And just clicks, going clicks, on and clicks, on clicks, and I'm just like yeah. It's like look at my shiny, like I'm putting oil on my dick, like, you know. I'm just like great, like, you know. But I'm supposed to like this shit now, like having fun. I don't need to see this shit, you know what I mean?
I do know what you mean, and like I'm all for the advancement of like scratching, I think it's great.
Yeah.
My name's the Scratch Bastid. I like scratching. But like I do feel that there's something lost. People don't apply it to something more than just the technique.
Mm-hmm.
You can practice the technique, but you've got to apply it to something. And if you got to find your own sounds, you got to be unique. Again, thing about standing out. You don't stand out if you're doing the same thing that everybody else is doing.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like you're just going to be another dude on Instagram scratch, and inside people, someone might get excited that you're doing a 7-click flare into a 4-click flare it's inner circle, but just understand, don't get high and mighty when you can't get a gig, or don't hate on other people that might not scratch as good as you because they don't put the time in that, because they might not see value in that, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you gotta don't forget like sometimes people look down on like club rocking DJs, but they don't understand that that's a super skill right there, like reading a crowd and staying up on your records and organizing your crates and dude, there's so many skills involved with that. And I learned that at an early age because I started as a battle DJ and I got put on that stage and I was 15 years old and like all I knew was my basement, so I practiced scratching and then I won the battle and I had only really played out like 3-4 minutes and I got a gig. And then I remember we getting to that gig, and then I was like, oh, damn. Like, I ran out of steam after, like, 15 minutes. Like I did all my routines, and I'm like, what do I do now? And then so then I started, I was like, okay. And then, like, I was still young, and, like, it was cool, it was fine. I kind of got the opening set because I kind of knew I was still kind of learning. And I stayed back, and then I watched the next DJs play, and there's some hip-hop DJs, house DJs, and jungle DJs, and I saw the way that they built their sets, and I'm like, this is really cool. So then I started collecting records, collecting music, and then from there I started building sets. And then I was still kind of underground at that time, and then so I played some like underground sets, and then someone from a club, like I won the second battle, and I kind of started to get more of my own steeds with the music, and then someone was like, you should come play this club. And then I went to the club, and that would have been like, I guess, kind of like the jiggy club, or it would like the hip-hop club.
Yeah.
And I was pretty underground at the time. But then, like, when I went there and I saw, like, what that was, I was like, oh, like, now I know why it says club version on the record, because this is the club. And, like, watching people dance to this and party, and I was like, oh, man, like, the way that the DJs could control the crowd and cut in little parts of the record, and they'd sneak in, like, the little melody or, like, a snare and the mixing and the trick mixing. I was like, oh, this is another level of skill, you know? Yeah. I think that some people don't expose themselves to enough of that, understand those levels of DJing. And like, I've always wanted to just continue to add to my, you know, my skill set, or my, I love all types of DJing. You know, when I first started, I was a little close-minded, and for those reasons, I'm also forgiving of people, kids. Sometimes people might comment something or say, it's like, oh, this is whack, or like, you can't do this, or something like that, or like
people leave these comments.
No, they don't really, but like some like sometimes almost by omission, though, you know what I mean? Like sometimes you're like, some people are just like not around, or like they're sort of like quiet on certain shit, you know what I mean? And you're like, you know, and it's like, all right, what, you know, like, I don't know, you can kind of read it, you know. But I think that, like, and as a kid, like, I hated house music, you know, and like, I love house music now. But like I went, and then I went to raves, and then I was like, oh damn, and I saw like beautiful girls dancing to house, like moving, and I'm like, man, this is why I didn't like house, because it didn't sound the same when I was like mowing my lawn. Like, you know, like, you know, right? So I think that like as a DJ, it's always important to stay learning and stay hungry and learning from
definitely.
And getting out there and going to different parties, and don't just scratch over Looper, and don't just do clubs. You got to go to some of the other spots, or you got to step outside your comfort zone and just,
exactly,
yeah. And that's a way to stay inspired as well, and like, and because like it can be, you can think this is the only way to do it, mm-hmm. but that can become like a bit of a vicious cycle, because then you can do only, then you start only doing one thing, or maybe you get bored or something like that.
Right.
And so you gotta get out there and expand your horizons.
Nice. Great message.
Yeah.
Should we end it on that? You got any more questions?
I got one more question. What used to pop off at Eagle Rock?
What did you say?
I'm not aware of the human serviette.
Okay, you said...
What used to pop off at Eagle Rock?
What used to pop off at Eagle Rock, man? I mean, we used to party at Eagle Rock for sure. So Eagle Rock was like... Damn, son. So...
how'd you know about this Eagle Rock shit?
So I used to live in a neighborhood called Eaglewood. Always up to no good. It was like super nice houses in there or something.
Yeah.
My dad is a real estate agent, and we like moved in. He's like, I know this neighborhood gonna blow up. So like he's like, we like got like this little bungalow in the nicest neighborhood, and this place called Eagle Rock was in there. Beautiful park, like, but it was also like just this weird like backwoods. Like it was crazy. But that's where we used to go drink and everything like that. And so we would all go to Eagle Rock, and the stupid kids. We would walk in there at like 6 p.m. with a 2-4 beer or something like that. And then we'd go party at Eagle Rock, and then it would get dark, and then we'd have to try to like basically walk out of the woods like basically rocks and sticks, and like every, like the next day people would come to school and like just bloody, you know. Stupid kids drinking in the woods. But that was Eagle Rock was our, I don't know how the hell you know about Eagle Rock, man. It's, but it does have the most beautiful view of Halifax, the Bedford Basin.
Who's that guy that interviews people and he just scares them because he
I just said it, Narwhal.
Narwhal,
the human serviette.
Yeah, that was your moment.
That was his Narwhal moment. Yeah, you wasted it on Eagle Rock though.
I have a few other ones, but that was like the best
one.
What
else? Come on, man. Hit me.
The chicken club?
The chicken burger.
The chicken burger, sorry.
Yeah. The chicken burger, man. That is Bedford, Nova Scotia. That's been there since, like, I don't know the date, like 52. It's like Dick's in Seattle.
Okay.
You know what I mean? It's the burger joint that been there forever. And yeah, it's like the people pull up their old school cars and stuff like that. They do the car shows and shit like that. Yeah.
Yeah, what more?
Give me one more.
That's it. Well, and then on that note.
Okay, you just Googled Bedford and that's what you got.
No.
Okay, you did a little homework. Okay, cool. But yo, well, I just want to say thank you guys for having me on the road.
Thank you for being here.
It's super dope.
We're going to look forward to, I guess, if we could like circle back, maybe just I want to get some feedback after the three style, the Taipei.
Yeah,
let me know.
Yeah,
and let me know, is the new Technics going to be available for that three style?
No, okay. New Technics available in June.
Ooh, spicy. June. Oh. Do you know the price?
Do you know the price?
$9.99.
Ooh, a pair one.
Yep, per.
Man,
$9.99. Okay, real quick, ooh, before we leave, ask a little steep.
Two G's. It's two G's.
What would you, if you had like the chance to get a set of either two 1200 with MK7s or two 12 Rains, what are you going with?
Two 1200s. Because I collect records. I still think the Rain 12s are a great tool. I think they're best applied as a backline item at like big booming festivals or like club. Yeah. Like I know Active uses them with Janet Jackson. Mm-hmm. JC uses it with Goody Mob and whoever he's touring with. Whatever.
Yeah.
I think they're great for like touring acts and playing shows. But for at home, when I had them set up, it's like they take up the space. I am a record, like I collect records all the time and I play records all the time. So I like the ability to like if that thing is taking up that much space and I can't play records on it, it's kind of at my home studio, it's not a good thing. And what I found with Rain, like, it was a little hard to get the 12s because they're they're just fresh out the thing. So we used them for the barbecue last year, and it was great because on the bus and outdoors, like right. they're amazing for outdoors because mm-hmm. no wind.
Yeah,
understand like it is kind of crazy that we use needles. Like it's like this little tiny thing that's like there's so many things that can go wrong. Factors, yeah. You know, so
there was a post with Miles Medina who recently said, "This is my first time experience the subs being so strong that it actually." Like bounce the needles off the vinyl.
Yeah.
And I remember he was like, how do you guys, you know, make sure that that doesn't happen?
Turn down the bass or like, you know what? Well, okay. Put,
we used to put napkins underneath.
Put napkins, yeah, toilet paper rolls.
And then some would put, the tennis balls?
Yeah, tennis balls.
Yeah.
I never knew about the tennis balls.
They cut the tennis balls in half and then they put it in the and stuff
yeah
like
we
that,
use yeah. like these practice hockey pucks that like orange they're that's oh, really? Super Canadian turntable shit
that is super
it's all
Canadian.
Because that's all you guys have
well they actually fit perfect
oh, okay
they're amazing. Kid Koala used to get
Kid
rolled
Koala, wow.
rolled another fucking paper. Name
oh, probably still does
big DJ
yeah man. I mean dude like it's funny we say that but like a guy like Kid Koala is like a super inspiration to me because like he has crafted a career like you think I got little things side projects that the things that guy does like puppet shows and like group turntable things where he's giving you records and you can all learn to play along like his concepts are crazy and he's made a great career out of being a DJ and it's just a very unique path like I'm super inspired by people like that
right
you know but yeah so he used to get a roll of toilet paper and on like some drum risers there'd be like a drum riser and then in between the two drum risers put a whole roll like a two like a 12 pack of toilet paper in there and that would absorb everything and toilet paper when you squish it is like super like so many layers of, they're super
right
absorbing and they even say it on the package but like that was a trick and it works it's crazy and like and I think you know what I think that stuff is that there's some magic in that. Like everyone has their own techniques of figuring it out. And I think that like as we go more and more towards like controllers or digital and people can like to complain about stuff. Look, DJing started as like figuring like applying using things to do it the wrong for not their original purpose, you know? So like don't be afraid to like just be a weirdo and figure out how to make it work for you. You know what I mean? Like sometimes people are like, it can only be done this way. You're like, no, fuck that. Like, let's, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, don't be afraid to think outside the box.
I'm waiting to see someone really utilize the reverse feature on the new 1200.
Oh, I can't wait to see that shit.
And then I'm also waiting to see how
Cut Chemist did it at the
a little
the
bit,
show.
But I'm want to. I mean, that was like, you know, playing a beat backwards and scratching. Yeah. Right, but I'm really waiting to see someone do some
crazy shit.
Yeah, like switching back and forth.
I can't wait for the next.
And then I'm also I realize it's probably gonna get oversaturated where everyone's gonna start doing it. But
so like, I'm over tone play and the reverse play.
listen, exactly. Well, I think to round out one thought that we were talking about earlier about the 1200s and like what they mean. It, I think it is a backline thing. Like you can't get 1200s on backline now because people think when they own it, that's the thing. But understand from an event production standpoint. Those things go way quicker, and they need new products. They need new, fresh things. Like even 900s, they go through them. Like you know what I mean? Like that when you rent something out, it gets used, and that's what's used commercially in clubs and events and everything like that.
Yeah.
And so when some people are like, "Oh, you didn't change much," well, it's like, yeah, it was a great thing to begin with, and we just need new ones. As much as yours might not be dying at home. You can't get 1200s at a lot of rental places right now,
right?
Yeah. You know, because they don't exist. So, so like, and I don't think I do think for sure that the 1200s is superior turntable to the PLX. PLX just doesn't do it for me. I have bad.
What's
feedback.
What's the PLX? Is that the Pioneer one?
Yeah.
I don't like those at all.
I tried that.
The pitch, the pitch is weird.
Have you noticed that when you, you know, when you kind of slow the record down when you're blending it with another, it speeds up.
Yeah.
Did you notice that?
Yeah, it fights against it.
Yeah, it's like
the torque adjusts.
The torque can sense when you're slowing it down, and it's just like, oh no, and then it starts speeding the BPM up.
Oh, and shit. The weird things go on the pitch, and also it's slow to react to your thing. I had this little like trick mix where I take Drop in Science by Craig G, which is like the the biggie the same the yeah, one more chance yeah, you know? and I do like the hot sex on a platter so I like drop it like a semitone basically like almost like minus four to plus where like, and it's like quick. I move the fader quick, and I tried doing it on the PLX, and it's like slow to respond to my movements. It doesn't work. And I did that live. Like I just assumed that it did it fine, and it was at a showcase that I was doing, and I was like, damn, like this is a new thing that I didn't know was whack about these things. Mm-hmm.
And the crowd was like, we're not going to buy his hot sauce. Fuck
that. Available at scratchbastid.com.
Yo, Scratch Bastid.
Oh, shit.
Mr. Bastid.
Yeah, man.
Thank Smurf. You for coming to Smurf.
Stimulus.
DJ. He's like when J. Cole was calling himself the therapist. That's you.
That was his first name?
The therapist.
Yeah. I actually know a DJ Stimulus. He used to do the good spot with MoMA.
Yeah. Shout out to Stimulus. I knew that sounded
familiar. Yeah. Cool. Yo, thank you for coming through.
Word.
Thank you, man.
Thanks.
Thank you, brother.
Pleasure, bro. Thank you for having me. Las Vegas.
DJ Bastid.